I will go to vote for that, but yeah, you know.
Okay,
let's do what you gotta do. Hello, Miss Nydia.
Hello, Mr. Clicker.
How we doing? Okay.
Pretty good. How about you?
Absolutely. Be happy to. Anytime.
Thank you.
Rutledge, how are you doing?
Good to see you too.
How are you? Good. Everything well? You got a tangle on that? He said you'd already figured it all out.
I got it all.
How are you?
Excuse me. Anybody here? I'd like to call a meeting to order. I'd like to call a March 11, 2014 work session to order at 2:01. If everyone would please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. Everyone for being out on this beautiful day.
We can meet outside.
Item 3, adoption of the agenda. Are there any changes to today's agenda?
I have a question. We've got on here e-cigarettes, and the lady that asked us to bring this forward for discussion can't be here, but for just at the beginning of the meeting. Could we move it? I know there's other people waiting to do one and two, and
those are going to be long ones.
Three, I mean.
Yeah. And we can maybe something else. How long can she be here?
I start teaching at 3:30, and I'll leave by 3. That's okay. Keep your agenda.
Okay.
We'll just
be
those there.
Okay.
Follow through, find out what
we
talked about. That'd be great.
Okay. You can watch the video.
Okay. Any other changes?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that we postpone item number 22 to April 22nd.
Item 22.
Second.
Motion is second. Item 22 to April 22nd.
Mm-hmm.
Item motion second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries. 3-2.
Move that we postpone item 21 to April 8th.
Second.
What day?
April 8th, work session.
Why wouldn't you do them on the same day? You just melt them in the new.
Because this one's been on the agenda since November. 22 has been on the November since February.
Are you sure you're just not trying to get one in before the other? And why wouldn't you just do them and save staff some money and just put them all together?
Well, maybe we'll look at that at the 8th.
Well, then why don't you reconsider your motion on the 22nd and move it to the 8th?
I think I'd
on the same day.
I'd like this one on the 8th. Put a lot of work on this one. It was on the agenda 3 months ahead of time.
Ahead of time?
Ahead of time.
What is the time it's ahead of?
It's ahead of item 22.
What does it matter? You do them all at the same time. And those guys will come with something
dangerous. We have a motion second, didn't we? Mm-hmm. Just make sure. Second, any more discussion? Make sure we have a second. And a motion second to move it to item 21, April 8th work session. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries 3-2. Commissioner, any other postponements, addition? Doug, do you have anything? Or Tim?
I don't have anything. Tim's got one.
I do have one. Item number 18, I would ask that just be removed from the agenda, please. Based on conversation that Board of Commissioners had last meeting, I think there was a general understanding to remove that.
Chairman,
second.
Motion second to remove item 18. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Tom, do you have any idea when your residential categories, the new ones we talked about, will be something back to the board?
We're working on it now. Staff's working on it. I haven't yet reviewed it, so.
Is that on agenda for the day?
No, it to me hinges with both of those things y'all were talking about.
We'll look at, see.
Can you just get back to us when you think you can? Just that as an estimate?
Is there a preference? We can make, the project we're bringing back is an outline, so it's.
Can you do it by April?
Shorter deadline?
April.
Just for details.
April.
Well, it's just going to be an outline, and then we're going to give you suggestions to go back and on.
Let's just do both.
I think we'll get there on April.
That'd be great.
Try to make it on the air.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Counselor.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I've got two that I would request be added on a time-sensitive basis. These will be short, I believe. The first one, Mr. Chairman, is a request for a resolution of the board authorizing the use of replacement counsel in a new lawsuit brought by Ricky Johnson against certain county actors. I'll discuss it when we get there, but I do believe I have a conflict and I'll need to recuse. So again, this would just be a resolution authorizing the appointment of conflict counsel.
And that is item 26?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Add resolution for a conflict replacement. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Mr. Chairman, the next item I have on a time-sensitive basis would be a proposed resolution authorizing the closing of Mullinax Road parcels 8 and 9.
So moved.
Second.
On a time-sensitive basis. All in favor, signify by saying aye. Saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. I can't write, talk, and say that. No problem. Counselor.
That's it, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
We need to mention all the going to executive.
I just want to say, do we have to mention them? We going to start off with executive session, Counselor?
We are going to start. Okay, well, then as part of your adoption of the agenda, yes, I would go ahead and request that the executive session be moved to the first order of business and then come back and finish the regular work session agenda.
And we only have one question at that executive.
That's correct. We'll save the balance of the executive session items for the end.
Okay. So we need to vote on that or just all?
Just as part of your adoption of the agenda, that'll be noted in the agenda.
Okay. Is there a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
Second.
Motion is second to adopt. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Counselor? I hear a motion to recess the work session and enter an executive session for discussion of litigation and acquisition and our personnel. And what happens, Counselor, after we come back?
After we come back, this will be just, we will reconvene the regular work session for all of the other open agenda items. This is going to be a limited executive session for one item, and then you'll have the rest of your work session following.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. We hate to have y'all step outside with y'all lives.
We have no choice.
Have no choice, you're right.
Kick me out too.
All good. Or do you mind or not? It cuts better with, Dave, it cuts better with police.
You were on the last one.
Dave, it cuts better with police.
Just thank you.
What are you doing with that information?
I know. Hello, Counselor. Don't say hello to me.
Hello, okay.
Sit with me on the clock.
Thank you.
Wait around with three, so I thought I'd come see.
Today, my staff came.
No, because I got three, and then I got five.
I'm going to go see it.
right there, and then the summary of the meeting will be posted on the website as well.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Can we?
I bet I think Carol does.
Carol only does.
Yeah. Take quiet and stuff. Cindy, you don't tell them.
No, I sure don't.
Your baby's gonna have hair. Gonna have hair?
One of these, this is in the hopper.
I agree.
I'll stop that.
I think it will eventually see some.
What's your bottom call? Recyclers and taking apart. There's always some trash.
That's like our main goal.
Drugs, you stink, you smell, you can take out a canister where it wasn't before, you know what I'm saying? It just becomes astronomical. And the people around are talking about it.
My sister starts to use it, so we must be college trying to pass this kid. So I wanted to have different.
Request the variance. It's just a letter.
Keep it coming.
My door has one wide, but it's not like a.
Oh, it is.
Yeah, but it's on the same property.
I'll go meet you. Go meet you.
I just noticed it.
I'll get it look like the same time one, but eventually.
It's all that blue dust.
It's gone.
I put a big sign back out, I said, well, stop.
I'll be there again. Right.
Miss Ken, the.
I like the way this soil is to get captured up very well. I put a few names for you to put in brackets.
Yeah, I added one. My books are the same. See, that really first bounce. It still bounces with the books, the same 33.
Yes.
Now we have two tap fees and then it sounds really.
I just want to check on my thing because I think some of the numbers are a little.
That's all right.
To my memory, they're like different city or something.
Oh, yeah.
I'll check.
All right.
Back to the bottom line. this gated.
We can tell it's changed. Purchase price. His purchase prices are all those.
Okay, it is.
You saw where it broke out? And there was right away, it was a different price. One had easements and record land. So I couldn't think I captured everything that was in there. And then where property was assigned to the short space, showed the price of that. So it's, I think the whole picture's there. You see the range of prices of land, you see the precinct, the different aspects.
Some of it, yeah.
What's it got in the bathroom?
Had to stay on.
Any other, up ahead of it?
You can't be working that much.
Got to come into the dam.
Yes.
Leaning.
Almost in there too, can you?
Here, they're like complicated. Because you're reading the closing statement, it doesn't tap to the other, like you didn't want to pay for it. Trying to add up all the things we pay.
Well, but he does.
Yeah, I've got the rest of the green now. I've got it in our files, the entire book. That was interesting. I just with the line chair, so that's what it's from all near land, where the land is budgeted for active space. And then just the 100,000 change over got moved over to green space. That was opposite of the others where they bought the GM, they just one lump sum, so I may have to make it a class. There's been some little things where calculations were rounded off on so many pennies and a few dollars.
Yes, so I yes. All yes, I saw that too.
It's awesome. Yeah.
Where I could.
One was confusing, but other than that, one I showed you the total cost breakdown of all was just starting from the price part here and purchase price. So I think it's a bit of a trail. You can see it on this paper.
Yes. I can call it.
Your worksheet looked at it and said, well, I know that makes sense, but then I'm going to look like this. You had it all there.
We've lost a county manager and a county attorney.
Brian, it's about 10. We can start with the presentation.
If they come back.
Yes, sir.
Brian got a phone start.
Second.
Well, they got there.
Put a GPS in.
No, I think they disappeared. We're going to start the ARC. Brian, Forsyth, over here. We say give him 2 minutes.
She had to then deducted something else. And that's how we got back to the 209, 889 or something. But I can't tell after the deductions. So what you had written, we paid.
We'll be joining Chicago, Los Angeles, New York. They just exited the very big city. Chicago, New York, LA, and coming.
On the acreage, they use the correct price that was in the
grade. We might have offered it for negotiation to the very last.
Yeah.
So that the might not necessarily match because the negotiations
I'm guessing the two with
the
price breaker change.
We'll start to Brian. Do I hear a motion to reconvene our work session of March 11, 2014?
Second.
At 2:56, I have a motion to second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Commissioner Pound being temporarily absent. Item number one is discussion with ARC regarding Forsyth County's participation in water supply providers group. Mr. Tim?
Yes, thanks, Mr. Chairman. Today, Ms. Catherine Zitch, who is the Natural Resources Division Manager with the Atlanta Regional Commission, asked to come talk to the board about a group that has been in existence for a long time. I'm not going to go into the details. I'll let her talk a little bit about the group. I've known of its existence for a long time. Occasionally, they would invite me down to listen in when they were involved in the Tri-State Water Wars litigation. Their biggest role, in my opinion, the last few years was assisting the state in the water wars. And they were engaged as an active party in the lawsuit. Most of the other members are members in the Atlanta Regional Commission. Gainesville, however, is also in the North Georgia Mountains Planning District. Gainesville's also been a party and a member of this group for a long time. When we were at meetings, it was a little bit concerning that we weren't at the table when they're negotiating water deals with Florida and Alabama for the Atlanta area. We were not at the table. Sometimes I was allowed to stay in the room. Sometimes they'd make me get up and go outside. I've been told by one of my counterparts that at one time when discussions were real close to a settlement, we weren't part of the settlement discussions because we weren't at the table. And Gainesville has told me that one of the best things they ever did was join the group. So there's a cost to it. The board considered it a few years ago. Like I said, they do a lot of study work. It could be as a group. They may study everything from the effects of rule changes on the temperature standards to the river to phosphorus levels, whatever else may need to be analyzed and studied. They've done things like that. And those are the types of meetings that they allowed me to attend. I was not allowed to attend anything that dealt with the litigation. But obviously, I think, you know, we're becoming a bigger player as far as water utilities in the state. We're fast approaching, you know, to be one of the top. There's not that many systems, really, more customers than us. So anyway, Catherine wanted to come back and talk to the board a little bit about the group and ask for consideration to join. I don't really expect you to have an answer today, but it's just jumping off point in the discussion, and then we can circle back from there. Ken's aware of this group, and had some discussions because in the past they have been evolved around litigation, yeah, but this is an open session type discussion. They're not involved in any litigation right now. So with that, I'll let Catherine talk a little bit about the group.
First of all, I want to thank you for having me here today. As Tim mentioned, my name is Catherine Zitch. I'm with the Atlanta Regional Commission, and since the 1980s, we've collected this group of water managers across really the Chattahoochee-Lake Lanier systems. The water managers include City of Atlanta, Fulton County, DeKalb County, Cobb-Marietta Water Authority, Gwinnett County, and as Tim mentioned, the City of Gainesville. And since the 80s, this group has been collectively funding both legal support and technical support to help with the water wars issues that have gone on for decades. Most recently, as part of the 11th Circuit Court ruling where Metro Atlanta got our water back, the group helped fund that effort and fund some of the arguments in the litigation through that process. Today, what we're working on is the Florida versus Georgia Supreme Court lawsuit. We're discussing this with the state and making sure that we're providing input as that process moves forward. We're also looking at water control plan updates with the Corps. We interact with the Corps very often in fact, right now we're working on a data request with them to make sure that they get what they need for Metro Atlanta. In U.S. Congress, we've been working heavily on the Water Resources Reform and Development Act, which is moving through. You may have seen the news articles recently about Port of Savannah. Also in that act, there used to be language that was directly attacking our ability to pull water from our lakes, and we were heavily involved in a coalition building exercise to address that issue. Water supply rules, and then there's also an ACF stakeholders group that deals with, from Florida, Alabama, and Georgia, many issues and trying to build together a coalition to help address the issues from a stakeholder perspective, and we're providing input into that. What I would say for Forsyth County is, as Tim mentioned, there's a lot of education and input that goes in from being a part of the group. So you become a part of the dialogue, it was before my time. I've been at ARC for about 14 months. Before my time, that the some of the settlement was going on in which Forsyth was not going to have a seat at that table. So being a part of the group helps make sure that your interests are looked after. The group, in fact, does fund a lot of the technical work that comes out of the state of Georgia, and we work closely with the state of Georgia on water wars issues. So to be a part of that dialogue moving forward, I think would be important to Forsyth County. As I mentioned, we have good relationships with the state and all the major players and can help represent that. And that's really the big picture. Entertain any questions you might have. Or I could talk for 20 more minutes and have settled.
Catherine didn't say it, but in my opinion and some others, you know, the recent success that Georgia had in the tri-state water wars, a lot of that came from on the backs of the study work and some of the work that the people they hired that were actively engaged in that. My opinion is I'm not sure the state would have been successful in the last round had they not been engaged, and it takes a lot of money. We've been able to sit back and kind of ride on the coattails of some of the bigger systems and the bigger users to help fund this, and it's probably time for us to get engaged.
What's the cost of it to us? Is it based on population, water users, or what's it based on?
It's based on the system size.
Yes.
The cost to the major systems would be much higher than the cost to Forsyth County. Are you looking for me to answer a specific question now?
Well, I'm sure we get some ranges, but it's based on water usage, I guess. Or customer base, I guess.
We would expect that Forsyth and Gainesville would be coming in at about the same level. And Gainesville is currently at $200,000
a year. And a year?
Yes, sir.
Wow. Is it appropriate to ask a question about the cost, Cam? Or is it making a difference?
It is. It's going to depend upon the comfort level that the ARC representative has in responding to it. We, you know, but yes, any question you all have is appropriate, of course.
Cam, would this $200,000 come out of water and sewer department?
Feel comfortable that it would, right, Dave?
That's a great idea.
Tim, are there any specific things that you're aware of that their organization got or talked about that we either would not have liked or we would have liked to have seen differently if we were a member of this organization?
I think we were fortunate in the some of the numbers that were put out there. I don't know what the settlement that was close to being offered to Florida and Alabama looked like as far as limiting water withdrawals from the lake, from the river, from who's going to get the expanded water withdrawal permits and who's not. So I really can't speak to that. That was always a concern that the governor's office was going to go down and try to settle the water lawsuit and put some caps in certain areas and us not be engaged. That was one of the hints I got from one of our neighbors that was a real risk because we weren't at the table in some of those discussions. I think it turned out okay. I just know that they funded a lot of the study work to talk about the environmental impact that really had on the mussels and the oysters and the sturgeons and to counter some of the things coming out of Apalachicola and the other places. You have to have scientific data and backup, and they funded a lot of studies and research to help provide that, not through their own attorneys, but to the state's attorneys also. And, you know, as we know right now, we're in a wait and see if the where the next step in the court case goes. What's the status?
Right now, the Supreme Court just ruled that they're going to have the U.S. Solicitor General weigh in. We expect that to take 6 to 8 months. So sometime in the fall of 2014, the Supreme Court would rule whether they're going to take the case or reject the case.
Let me ask you one more question.
In Florida's suit, they've specifically named as one of the suit was against the state of Georgia and the Metro Atlanta water users, and named Forsyth County its water use as one of the named, what would you call that, in the suit, we were named in the suit as one of the people as being part of Metro Atlanta.
Well, the Metro, does the cities belong to a separate, they belong like Atlanta or Gainesville? Gainesville belongs to Hall County, does
Gainesville does all Hall County's water.
I know, but I mean, but Hall County's, do they have a water system, myself?
They consolidated.
They gave it back to Gainesville, didn't they?
They did, but they're still, Hall County is moving forward with Glade without Gainesville at this point. So they're still, it's officially merged, but there's still some separate actions going on that involve water.
How about the city coming along?
They could. It's not limiting them. I think the ARC has reached out to the bigger water users that get their water from the Chattahoochee. You might notice Cherokee County's not in there. That's because their water comes out of the Etowah, and they've mostly focused on the effects from the Chattahoochee and Lake Lanier.
I spoke to Trish Barmeyer after this was on the agenda. It's been on the agenda some time ago, and one of the things that just was concerning to me, just because I didn't understand it, was if, I know this group gets together and discusses strategy and discusses what's in the best interest of advancing the agenda of the respective stakeholders, but what happens when there's actually court filings? I didn't understand that, because an unaffiliated group really can't make a court filing. And what Patricia told me is that once they sort of develop a plan, then they come back to the actual governments upon whose behalf they want to submit documents, and they will seek your permission, whether it's in a resolution or a motion, for this action to be taken on your behalf. In other words, you're not going to find yourself on the bottom of a V somewhere and don't know how in the world you got there because you hadn't signed off on anything. That was important to me, that you would have one more sort of bite at the apple before anything's filed on behalf of the county.
But this $200,000 a year wouldn't turn into, well, we've got another $100,000 or additional monies that you need to bring forward.
All I anticipate is $200,000 a year.
Yeah, and I had that discussion, and she's correct. I mean, they try to set a budget based upon historical experience. Candidly, I mean, there's a lot of folks contributing, so that should get you quite a bit of participation. If, however, the litigation really heated up, I suspect a couple of things would happen. Probably there would be, Tim would come back to you and say, look, all of the groups are being asked to put in another draw to further fund ongoing litigation efforts. And I think that it wouldn't happen without you knowing about it, and it's probably a situation where you would say, you know what, we're good.
We're good. And we're totally dependent upon the lake. I mean, as our water source.
Totally dependent on the Chattahoochee.
Yep. You, and I think you probably want somebody there looking after our interests at all times.
At all times.
Well, so what's the thing to ask for a resolution or further study or approval of a budget payment or?
I don't know, Tim. I mean, do you all view this as time sensitive, such that we need to approve something today? My preference would be a resolution authorizing the contribution, a resolution, just a little bit of explanation what we're doing and why, and bring it back to you at another work session, and ultimately go on a consent agenda. Because you're authorizing a pretty good chunk of money, I think there needs to be a little support outlining why we're doing it.
Wouldn't that have to go through the Water and Sewer Authority first, or just come straight to us?
Straight to you.
Once this water wars thing is settled, if and when it is, I mean, is this something that we could reevaluate then and say, do we want to remain in it? Or is there benefit to remain?
Able to back out any time.
I think the way it stands now with the water providers that are in it, most of them provided funding for approximately a 3-year period that has carried us through 5 recently. That's not necessarily, I wouldn't want to set that expectation moving forward. And then when we need more funding, we go to each of them. And at that point, the discussion happens all over again.
Right.
So it's not a one time and you're in it for life kind of situation. It's more every time that
some of the systems participate in this group and fund their own legal involvement in the actual case on top of this group.
So you're looking like a 3-year commitment. What you're looking for is a year at a time.
I think it's more like, I don't mean to answer, but again, having spoken with Patricia, I think it's more like we pay an opt-in fee and it gets us as long as the collective has the money to get us. So it may be 2, maybe 3 years.
So it's not every year, $200,000.
No, I didn't take that away at all from my conversation with
Well, I would expect, because of the funding situation, Forsyth will not be paying an equivalent to some of the larger funders. They paid a one-time, much larger fee. I would expect Forsyth to be more on the $200,000 annually. We're currently expecting the current amount of funds to run us through some point in 2015.
And so we would be looked at every year.
Unless you want to pay the higher amount one time.
What's the higher amount, 400?
I'm not going to, I would prefer not to answer.
Yeah, that's fine.
Way more than that.
Let's talk. Is there any, y'all, are we interested, like Jim said, doing a resolution or looking and writing a resolution to look at this?
I don't think we'll have much
choice. That goes directly to Ken.
Would you want our, and I assume that the group anticipates a representative from the county to be at these stakeholder meetings? Would that be Mr. Perkins? Is that who you'd want me to draft the resolution? I mean, I assume that. I just
We have to name, just say head of the water and sewer.
Well, right.
Yes.
Or a designee. Or a designee in case he's not available. And you don't want to have to deal with that mess.
Okay.
And does that give Tim Perkins some more job security that way?
Nope. As long as you got the designee.
Yeah.
Council, how's that?
Mr. Chairman, I'm good because you're going to have to vote on the resolution. I don't need official action. I think I've got your direction. I'll bring you back a resolution. You can take official action then.
Is there any other questions for Catherine from the board since she made a long trip up here?
Thank you.
Is this something we need to do quickly?
Yeah, well, I said we'll attend the vote.
Can't bring it back to us.
I'll have it to you at the next work session.
Yeah.
Okay.
Less than mine.
We've been planning to do this since the snowstorms of January.
She's been on the agenda, both snowstorms.
Well, she's had two snowstorms.
I told her if it snowed today, don't come back.
Yeah.
That was the sign.
Thank you all for your time.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you.
On item two, discussion regarding the development potential of 33-acre parcel on Veterans Memorial Parkway. I think Randall Toussaint of the Chamber is handling this today.
Good afternoon.
Hi, Randall.
We're doing a PowerPoint?
Yes, sir.
Oh,
just wanted to first thank y'all for allowing me to speak with y'all to provide you with an update. You know, whenever we mention economic development, that always means different things to different folks. We were giving a presentation the other day at a civic organization. We were talking about all the good things that were coming in and how the University of North Georgia has opened their new campus here and got no applause for that. We're talking a little bit about how our manufacturing sector, our healthcare industries are beginning to grow and thrive. No applause for that. And then we gave an update and just said Cracker Barrel is lighting it up still and got a standing ovation. But the reason I mention that, though, it's a great example. It means different things to different people. And for us, economic development just always comes down to the community itself and how do we work on preserving the economic vitality of where we live. We measure that very specifically in terms of jobs and capital investment. And we were asked to take a look at the 33-acre site along Veterans Memorial and to explore the feasibility of creating new jobs and capital investment out of that site. So that's what I'd like to present to you today, just a brief update and overview on our findings. If we take a look at the site itself, we've got the marker there for 608 Veterans, but you can see here it's highlighted in red. It's a 33.85 acre site located right there along Veterans Memorial. If we were to zoom in there, you can see it's located just south of where we are currently at the moment. And the site itself has had an interesting history in terms of economic development exploration. In 2011, Wakefield Beasley had prepared a conceptual rendering that explored the feasibility of bringing retail, industrial, and office to the site. The site itself called for retail out parcels to be developed right here along Veterans Memorial, and it explored the feasibility of developing several hundred thousand square feet of flex warehouse space that could accommodate an industrial user or an office user. The concept itself was something the development authority asked us to take out into the development community and
and ask what the feedback was. And after doing a bit of a litmus test, we discovered a couple of key things. The first was that the site itself has several environmental challenges, namely the topography being one. There's several encroaching floodplains and streamlines, as you can see there, that go through the site that would prohibit it from being developed in the manner that was originally presented in the Wakefield-Beasley plan. So with that being the case, we reached out to our partners at the Community and Economic Development Office of Georgia Power and asked them if they could assist us with exploring how this site could be developed to accommodate roughly the same square footage that was presented in the 2011 conceptual rendering, but using the existing topography that's currently there at the site. And through the new conceptual plan, we were able to take a look at several ideas or concepts, if you will. And you have these in your book also, and we've separated them into version A and version B. If I click on this, it'll open up a larger site. This is a rendering, again, that Georgia Power produced at no cost to the taxpayers. And it takes a look at exploring the feasibility of what could be developed on the property. You're looking at a 60,000 square foot building that has approximately three stories at 20,000 square feet per story. And it's using the existing topography once again. Now, as we back out of the site, you'll notice that they still kept the initial corridor that would access Veterans Memorial, but used it in order to develop a much more elevated plan for what office space could be. And you'll see two buildings there that have approximately 80,000 square feet per building. That's 20,000 square feet per floor with two four-story structures, with the parking to accommodate that. And we thought that this was a viable option, but after taking a look at this rendering, it was very clear to us that only about approximately 30 to 45% of the site would be able to be used to develop this concept, which is vastly different from the original rendering that was developed with our partners with Wakefield Beasley. And you can see it's kind of locked in two pockets here for development to allow for that original area there in the middle to serve as where our waterways are running through. We also took a look after bringing that to the market at what could be developed in terms of more of an industrial concept. We have several local companies who are on the verge of expanding, and they are in need of more industrial space. And because of that, we want to make sure that we're able to accommodate the growth of our manufacturing sector. So due to that, we took a look once again at the rendering. And again, that's conceptual plan A. And as we float to the second one, conceptual plan B, you'll see a vast difference here. The original site of 60,000 square feet remains, but we've explored the feasibility of developing 80,000 square feet of flex industrial space with the parking to accommodate that as well. And we'll go into Georgia Power's rendering once again. The original layout that you saw in the first plan remains unchanged. That's a 60,000 square foot building with three stories and 20,000 square feet on each story with the parking to accommodate the site. But once again, the change here for this conceptual plan is that we wanted to explore the feasibility of developing the site more so to accommodate a manufacturing user. And that's where the change happens here along this direct corridor. You can see the roadway is a little bit wider to accommodate trucking access. And I'm always blown away when folks are able to put little itty-bitty trucks into the renderings, and they were able to do that there. But here you have the structures that we were referencing. You have two 40,000 square foot flex industrial spaces. You can notice here that we have approximately 90 parking spaces, 88 to be exact. And then on the back side here, we were able to access 28 truck bays. And we took this out and just asked folks what their thoughts were for both of the projects, both of the conceptual plans. And we received some favorable recommendations for both of them. However, we have several users who have confidently shared that they are interested in the industrial sites within the next 18 months, if that were feasible, due to their expansions. And typically, when we see this type of a development take place, There's the next question that usually is brought to fruition is how much does all of that cost? The thing that we always recommend in terms of developing a feasibility, this concept, is to measure three times and cut once as opposed to just moving directly in. And our recommendation, and especially since we've seen this work in other communities, is to actually issue possibly an RFP as opposed to just moving forward with trying to develop it itself to see what the market actually says. We've shot this to several users, but rather than actually putting real capital behind it, I think it's worthwhile to allow the development authority as a recommendation to go forth with issuing an RFP to the market to see what they think and how they feel it could be developed.
So the concept isn't that there's somebody who would like, some private company who would like to build this and either occupy it or rent it. The concept here is that through some entity of the government will pay to build this and we will become potentially the renter.
There actually have been examples where both cases have worked.
Which one are we talking about here?
With this one, I recommend, and I know this is ambiguously vague but presently clear, I recommend that we take a look at using the RFP as a tool to determine which of those concepts will work for the current market conditions.
How much acreage, percentage of land at this plant? You said of it only use like 30%, 32%?
Yes, sir. Both plans actually use the same percentage. The only change is just in the layout of the industrial space versus the office space.
Now, if the authority went for RFP, explain what they do with that. What would be their concept?
Through an RFP process, the development authority could potentially be allowed to present all of the information that we have here, as well as any existing data that might exist about the site, including zoning plats or parcel information. To potential developers and allow for them to actually come up with their version of their own rendering of what they think could be the case and a development scope of work or a plan of action that they feel could be taken. Now, when that's occurred in the past, we've seen it become very evident where the market is because a lot of that will be capital driven. Most developers won't recommend anything that they don't feel they can't get funded. Just to be blunt.
Out of the size of the tract is 33, what is it, how many acres?
33.85 acres.
And of that, how much is usable land?
Approximately 25 acres, ballpark.
Is there a value of the land in which we could think to recapture?
It's a great question. I think in any exploration that we do of this, it should be clear that we probably will not see the full value of what was purchased return upon the initial development. The capital investment that would be gained from this would be something that would be gained over time through property taxes and investment from any commercial user that moves into the site.
On the building on the front, was there a reason you're only going three floors? Is it you don't have enough parking to accommodate for a fourth?
It could go higher, but our request to the team that actually developed the conceptual rendering was to see if we could possibly match the square footage that was found in the 2011 concept. And again, this is essentially a very pretty drawing as opposed to real engineering plans.
But this takes into the contours of land. The first 2011 drawing really didn't take into contours of land.
Yes, sir.
That's the difference.
Yes, sir. But
if I heard you right, so correct me if I'm wrong, there's 33 total acres there and roughly 35-ish percent is buildable. Did I get that right?
Ballpark.
That's a number more like 15 acres than 20.
Agreed. But again, part of that, it depends on how the renderings are laid out.
I heard that too, Jim. I thought you.
Thank you.
It's just, I guess it's because of all the water and the bad soils and the contours?
Yes, sir. Because of the contours, and there's actually a waterway that cuts through the middle there. It would prohibit development from being done at a level that wouldn't be cost prohibitive.
Well, the county could basically look at long-term, as you talked about, getting that money, original investment back. It would be a long-term process of taxes and sewer with them.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
The
bottom line is, if you, let's say you get one third of what you invested in that. Yeah, you could count all your taxes over the years, you can count your sewer over all the years, until you add up to a number that you say is the amount, or you could actually sell it for what you paid for it and get even more money by collecting the same taxes and the same sewer, and the same, but you're not going to get it because the value of the land's not there.
Yeah, you're right. That's the right, that's a big deal. But we could also encourage job growth in here.
That's good. That's a good thing too.
Is this included in the work opportunity zone? Isn't parts of the city coming included in that?
Yeah, it is. And right now, the opportunity zones have been placed, I guess, in a state of stagnancy within the Department of Community Affairs. They're exploring to what extent they want to continue the program.
They have more opportunity
for the opportunity zones. But this does fall within the eligible area for an opportunity zone. Based on the initial map.
So what would you like from us today?
Well, the initial thing, or the main purpose of the presentation today really was to provide you all with an update. You all had requested that the Development Authority explore the feasibility of developing a conceptual plan that could generate economic activity at the site. And we really want just to make sure you were aware that first activities have been taking place and that we do have some ideas and concepts. I think the next step that could potentially happen would be for the Development Authority to explore the RFP process.
Now, let me ask Tim, I think we have looked at part of this for the water and sewer. But
yes, sir.
But we determined it's kind of not the place we want to be.
It's It could be used, but I don't know that it's really where we would like to be. I think our first primary location would really be to stay on County Way if we could, because of the infrastructure we already have up there. But at some point, the utility, public utilities, water and sewer will be looking for room to expand. As you all know, we are outgrowing this building every day. So at some point, we've got to find a office or headquarters for them. There's a concept of a one-stop shop where a developer or a homeowner could come to one location, park their car, get out. They may go to two or three different buildings to do their business, but they don't drive all over town. That's probably what we want to foster and try to stay either in this building or somewhere nearby this building.
So we can make it a one-stop walking within distance thing.
Yes, sir.
That's a bit too far out to,
yes, sir,
to walk to it. So that's one of the things that was looked at.
Yes, sir.
So have you presented this to the Development Authority, Randall?
Yes, sir.
Do you want to do anything with this? Should I just look at it right now?
I think it'd be great if this is me personally, proceed with this.
Yeah, for RP, it's not going to be a big deal to see what comes in.
You need that in motion, can or just all?
I don't think we would even be soliciting the RFP, right? It'd be the Development Authority.
Yes,
no action from you.
Take it forward, right?
Yes, sir.
Any objections?
No. Thank you, Randall, sir. You did a nice job.
George Power. Thank George Power for that.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Great job.
Yep. Thank you.
Item 3, ratification of purchase of services, MOU, with accountability, of course. Before we start, Ken, I'll ask one quick. There's four people on here. We have four different MOUs with their names on it. Can we do this one MOU? We have to do it individually for each person.
1 second, Mr. Chairman. The verbiage in the MOUs is the same?
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Just has a different name.
I would be comfortable with us doing that as one motion.
Thank you, sir. All yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. If you remember previously, we brought this same matter to you on the accountability of courts, and we do need more drug screeners available to make the program work more efficiently. So we're bringing forth four more. The courts have approved it. We just need the board's ratification of the MOU. So we are asking to allow Deidre Dean Kyle, Gavin Botter, Stephen Shane Lively, and Nicole Halpin to be drug screeners as needed. Thank you.
Questions from the board? Do we hear a motion? Ratify?
Make a motion that we ratify the agreement accepting the four new accountability courts drug screeners, Deidre Kyle, Galvin Walter, Stephen Shane Lively, and Nicole Patel. As presented.
Second. Motion and second for approval of item three, MOU. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item four, Donna, this is a time-sensitive item two.
This is, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you. This is for the purchase of the Ballot on-demand system processing and service agreement for our voter registration department. It is a sole source. They do provide this service for other voter registrations. And what it will do is allow our voters department to actually print the ballots as needed on demand, literally what it says, so that they don't have to, we don't have to print a whole lot because we have to have them available. So sometimes we'll have too many and then they are a waste. So it's a cost to sit on the shelf and get rid of them. This is where they can really just print as many as they need to have on hand. This includes all the software, hardware, maintenance, and consumables and set up services for them. And the cost is $16,400. There is an agreement that has been approved by legal in it. And just so you're aware, that maintenance would not begin on this program until year six, and that would be at $1,000 per year.
Can I ask you a couple questions?
Sure, and I think voter registration is here too, behind you somewhere.
Why isn't this just called a printer?
Because it sounds better. It's a ballot on-demand system.
I mean, just spit out some extension of Word and put ballot at the top of it, type it in, and then say
it costs $16,000.
It's the whole software setup, so it prints all the language that they need. So it looks like a
okay. I know these people will say, I'm going to use this word. When it doesn't work, what do you do?
That is something actually we have discussed. And the other, there's a couple things that can happen. One, part of the service agreement is they have to be on site in such a period of time. But the other thing is some of the counties around us are using it as well. And we would be like a band of brotherhood. We would band together to make sure it worked.
Yes.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, I mean, we'd have to maybe have to use theirs and vice versa. Okay. It could happen to us.
So the purpose of this is somebody standing there and says, I'd like a ballot.
No, they'll have it printed. They can print so many, their estimate ahead of time.
Okay.
But if they are running low, they can print more instead of us having to go to the printer. Because we pay to print them. And we always will.
What's that cost roughly?
I don't have it off the top of my head. It's not cheap.
It's not.
And we usually print too many.
We buy a bulk amount. But if we didn't print enough, to print in small amounts costs three times as much.
And the problem is we can't run out.
Overprinting with a bill of $200 a year goes into $16,000 a lot.
It costs more than $200 a year.
Anyway, the Board of Elections would like this, is that right?
Absolutely. And the reason they want it time sensitive is because of the elections that are upcoming.
We are moving county. Any other questions? I hear a motion from the board for item four, time sensitive.
Okay, one more question, please. Has this been tested before in other jurisdictions?
Yes,
have they had issues, and what's the percentage of issues? I mean, I can't imagine the day of, all of a sudden they're not printing, they're running every which way trying to get ballots.
No, and just to be clear, this is for absentee ballots that go out of the mail.
Okay.
So basically the soft part of the software is the fact that if I'm sending you a ballot, you've requested it, it's going to your house, it's pulling all that information over, it's pulling over what districts you're in.
One absentee ballot.
I can write that software.
You printed for $16,000.
You got crayons to draw those up.
I hear a motion now from item four.
I'll make a motion that we approve the ballot on demand system processing and service agreement for the voter registration department at a cost of $16,400, time sensitive.
Second.
Say what?
Thank you.
Now, motion second on time sensitive item four for approval. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item five, Donna.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I apologize that I could not have this backup in your books. This is for geotechnical materials testing for the Shakerag Water Reclamation Facility that's going under construction, and at this time we do need the services of geotechnical testing. And we went to our pre-approved firms that we have five of, and Nova Engineering provide the most comprehensive plan for the project. And this would be all-inclusive for the duration. based on our schedule and our current plans and what we currently think we'll need at the site. So we would like to propose acceptance of the proposal from Nova Engineering and Environmental in the amount not to exceed $62,530. And the reason we're asking for this to be time sensitive is we do need them on site immediately.
Any questions from the board? Do I hear a motion from the board?
I'd like to make a motion that we make an award for geotechnical and special testing for the Shakerag Water Reclamation Facility to Nova Engineering in an amount not to exceed $62,530. Time sensitive. Do you need anybody to sign for this?
The county manager will sign the purchase order.
Approval for the county manager to sign the purchase order.
Second, time sensitive.
Motion second, time sensitive, item five for approval. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. And I would like to say, if y'all haven't been out to Shave Right Light lately, you need to go out there and look. You know, it's a pretty piece of land with a sewer plant coming right along nicely. Item six.
Item six, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is approval for services with CH2M Hill in regards to a data management system. This item was budgeted, and it is in the cost of $202,269. This basically will provide a centralized data management system for the engineering department because they have a lot of data for their stormwater and also engineering's here for any additional questions. Of all their different systems, their stormwater management system, complying with all the permits that they have, this will allow them to gather all the data together in a more expeditious fashion, and it would help reduce the need for additional staff to correlate this information, as well as help keep our consultants' costs down and assist us with compiling our reports. Thank you, Tom.
Any questions for services to CH2M Hill?
This is not time sensitive.
No, it's not. Do I hear a motion from the board? I make a motion we approve the services of CH2M Hill in regards to a data management system in the amount of $202,269.
Second. Is it time sensitive?
No, it's not. Now, a motion and second for approval item six. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Donna, can you do one more?
One more, sir. Thank you. This is for a manhole inspection and the construction observation mobile application with WK Dixon for our water and sewer department. This is actually a mobile application, an app is what it will be. It will be used by the water department. It will expand their current enterprise GIS solution by allowing the field and office personnel to access the water and wastewater data through the website. WK Dixon has made this app. It's there, and once we buy it and have it installed, it is ours, and we will not have to pay licensing fees or things like that. The first year, the app will be hosted by WK Dixon, and then after that, it will be hosted on our county site. And our IS&T department has reviewed this and said they're capable of handling this. We would like approval for the manhole inspection and construction observation mobile applications with WK Dixon in the amount of $22,000. And county manager to sign the agreement that has gone through legal.
And I guess I could have called the sewer out for him to make sure.
The budget amount was $96,000, and the amount is requested to be $22,000. Are there other things left to come?
There are other software items.
How did I guess that?
Yeah. You think it was a good deal?
Sounds good.
Are there other things yet to come out of this particular budget? Was this budget for this particular software? Or?
I think the budget included more items than this particular software.
Correct. Yeah, it's other items. It's the majority of that's for an asset management software. These are the components that feed into that. But we originally had planned to use laptops to be able to get the GIS data out in the field. And this was an application that we saw that WK Dixon had developed for their own inspections when they do projects. It's a lot cheaper. It allows you to use tablets and iPads that are half the price of a laptop. And very, very sleek program that they developed for their own work, and it feeds right into the system really well.
So you over budgeted here because this is cheaper now for the laptop.
Well, we had to use that money along with the to get there. They're gonna use it something too.
Oh,
any other questions?
Do to you, Tim?
Do we hear a motion for item seven? Sometimes it's in the meeting.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve the manhole inspection and construction observation mobile application for W.K. Dixon for the water department in an amount not to exceed $22,000.
Would you approve it?
I think that approval the county manager signed the necessary documentation.
Second.
Have a motion and second for approval item seven. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Thank you, Don.
Thank you.
Proposed budget for the purpose of a possible park and rec bond. Mr. Doug and Jerry.
Yeah, you probably don't need me to queue this up for you, but I will. You've discussed this in previous meetings. One, to bring back to the board the park and recreation bond projects list, those that I think Park and Rec and others may have identified. The other information you requested at a previous meeting was for finance. Dave, we and the staff put this together, and you should have it in your book as an insert, is the estimated bond impact to a homeowner. And it was based on house tax appraisal value of $250,000, $150,000, and $350,000. So that information is there for you to consider as well, and I'm sure Dave could shed any light on that particular document should you have any questions. So I don't know how you want to proceed. If you want to go through the project list with Jerry, or Jerry, do you want to discuss how you got to that point?
Yes, we met with the Parks and Recreation Board and staff, and this is a, y'all have a list in front of you that we came up with, proposed projects. I can go over each one of them if you like. We can go down the line. We just started with park improvements, which would include fencing at baseball, soccer fields, athletic fields, tennis court lighting, repaving parking lots, landscaping, remodeling buildings, replace three artificial turf fields at one at each park, which would be Bennett, Sharon Springs, and Midway. Those are the first three parks we did, and they got to be recarpeted within the next 5 years. And also add two artificial turf fields at Central Park, and renovation of baseball fields. Some of the fields are getting where they need to be, and go in and just re-landscape the fields, re-sod them. Matt Community Park, phase two. That is a park we're working on phase one now. We'd go back in on phase two and finish up the baseball, softball fields, tennis courts, and walking trails. On the Airland Park, phase two will be the music venue, still to be determined if when the study comes out and we evaluate that, we'll know which way we're going. And also baseball, softball fields, tennis courts, and walking trails at Lanierland. Hall Creek Park, design and construct a community gymnastic building. We have to purchase back 5 acres from the green space if we put a building like that over there. South Forsyth Athletic Complex, add a new complex in the south end of the county, land acquisition, design and construct baseball, softball fields, tennis courts, rectangle fields.
When you talk about purchasing back the 5 acres on Hall Creek,
right,
would you not purchase it back at the same price that the county bought it at?
I'm sure we would.
Okay,
so it would be
because
less.
The county didn't pay but 30 an acre.
Okay, so it would be less money.
I mean, it's just a little bit under that.
Right. We moved on to Matt Community Park. We put design and construct another rec center. Of course, as we've discussed in the past, going on that Lanierland may be a good spot for once you can decide in the future where we would put that, either Matt or Lanierland. The lake parks we received from the Corps of Engineers. In the next 3 years, we've got to do a conceptual master plan and an environmental assessment. And also some money's in there to develop some of those parks. So if we move forward with those parks, within the next 3 years, we have to do some of these things. And the other things would be aquatic center, you know, in the next 8 years, whatever, 5 to 8 years, you could design and construct an aquatic center in the south end of the county, and also purchasing land for future parks was listed.
Jerry, on the South Scythe Athletic Complex, how many acres of land do you think you need for that?
I would say anywhere between 30 and, I don't know, around 20 acres.
Have we located any land down there?
No, sir.
This comes to, like you said, grand total of $100 million, but Mr. Gruen started out $150 million on our estimates here. We asked him for more money than the $100 million. We go up to $150 million.
Not that I know.
No, sir. This was originally discussed as part of a transportation bond.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why we started at 150.
Okay.
Was, but I think that you could.
And we can tell that. I just want to miss something. We're missing something with some other else. Needs or wants from anybody.
Yeah, we can calculate very quickly the what it would, how it would impact the $50,000.
Right, so this another 100 million. How far along are we in that last 100 million bond?
Well, let's see, from the first 83 million, getting to the end, we might have 6 or 7 million of that left, maybe a little bit more, and then we did, then we borrowed the last 17, so
how many
still over 20. Oh, how many years?
How many years have we got left on
paying it off? I think it was a 30-year bond.
It's a 30-year bond?
2028, yeah. We're 6 years into it now.
And we've still got several projects not to be complete, that we haven't completed. In my district.
Yeah, but that was part of the process for doing one of the projects. I know, but otherwise it would have been done. In other words,
it's been started.
That the county could have moved forward with that. I think that, well, thank you, Jerry, for doing this. I think it's important that, you know, we went through one of these before and it seemed to go pretty well. I mean, the citizens are very happy with the results, but I think that we might want to consider some language if you went forward with something like this about some sort of division amongst districts or some sort of agreement that, you know, if let's just say you had 20 million in district, that if you were going to give up some of that, that it might require the vote of the district commissioner, because a lot of these things are on the line, or lines will change in 6 to 10 months, or they'll, in 8 years, we'll change the district lines again. Here we are 6 years later, we're still building projects. I just think so that to get everyone, not only the board members, but the citizens comfortable with it, there ought to be some sort of understanding about division being done fairly.
Are you thinking to do this when you're trying to do a transportation bond?
This is only information about that.
I think this is just information, and we should just be talking about it amongst ourselves and amongst the citizens.
See if it's a need for it, or see if people want to do it.
I think the master plan will show there is a need for at least the priority A projects, correct?
Right.
Dave, I just want to be clear. I'm sure that you said it, but just looking at this list, if we start, well, for any category, we'll just start with the $150 million, where you have different appraisals for houses. Are you saying, I don't believe you're saying that in 10 years, a taxpayer would have paid $158 over that 10 years, that's per year, is that not true?
Right, that's correct, this is okay. Per year. That's correct.
I think it's important to point out that the topic of the last bond was first brought up in 2006 when we had the master plan presented to us. Voted on in 2008. Here it is 2014, we're still building projects. So it does take a while to first get it out there, voted on, everyone informed.
Kind of like building roads.
Kind of like building roads. But we need to think ahead.
Got something, if you don't mind. When you're considering this, all aside, when you divide it out by value of a home, and a $400,000 house versus a $200,000 house has the same, or possibly has the same four people in it, the $400,000 house is going to use a park, possibly the same as a $200,000 house, but yet they're going to be paying twice as much if you do it by millage instead of by home. And that's just something you might want to consider. Also, another thing to consider is, if we're able to increase the fees when developers develop and builders build, and allow, because we might need these new parks for all the new people coming, why should they not help pay to get them going?
Well, we do have an impact fee.
But why don't we increase those impact fees?
We're looking at the impact fee structure.
He's going to come back with a new
because that may cover some of this if we get that correct.
Well, impact fees participated and contributed to some of the projects we have on now in conjunction with the park and rec bond money before.
I agree. But I just think the taxation, if you're going to do something, ought to be fair for household, and one household should not pay substantially more if they're only using it the same. Same thing when you do your roads. If you have two people driving in a house, why should a guy that was an $800,000 house pay four times as much as a person who's 200 miles around if you do by millage.
Based on the millage rate.
Just saying, they're only using the roads the same amount.
Then we need to put toll booths up.
Yeah.
If you're gonna.
Or you do it by household.
So.
You do it by car.
What if you're an empty nester? What if you don't drive?
There's another thing that you need to think about, because is it fair to charge somebody tax or something like that?
Yeah, but how are you gonna get started by it?
Taxation without representation, you gotta be careful how you.
That's why you get exemption for.
Both of these things that we're talking about are gonna be voted on by the voters.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like we're.
We're not deciding.
In case you can hear with Mr. Forsyth, that's why it's exemption for schools, because they're not, seniors aren't using.
True, but their property values increased because of.
Because of ones that use.
Just like property values.
That's a user pay system.
Let's get back on topic here at park.
Right. Make the argument that the projects at the parks add to people's property values.
I can agree with that.
Whether they're in a bigger house or a little house.
They also take the expense off the developer for not having to put up swimming pools and tennis courts and stuff in this community.
I think we need to seriously look at the impact fees and then reevaluate this based on.
I do too. I think the impact fees ought to come first.
We're not deciding this today.
I understand.
But at least we need to have a discussion.
That's why I'm doing my discussion, and we're not deciding today. Put my 2 cents worth in. And then another 2 cents.
One more question before we move on, and I was just thinking back on Park and Rec Board. Are we looking in this, I know you've got the South Forsyth Athletic Complex, but is there any consideration to the expansion of Sharon Springs in this? Because, I mean, back when I was on the board, it was a lot more cost productive. It was way better to expand a current park because you didn't have to hire all new staff. You had staff already there. And way back then, Sharon Springs was bursting at the seams even then.
I'll just go ahead and say it. We appraised property adjacent to Sharon Springs,
right.
And we could not come to terms with sellers in the area.
Okay.
We tried. I agree with you. It would be ideal.
I know all those parents really want it, too.
But, you know, we can't pay five or six times appraised value for a piece of property.
Can't condemn it.
No.
Any other questions at this time? Thank y'all for information, Jerry. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Bring it back up on a future date. Item 9, County Initiative Rezoning the Mack Community Park, A1. Director of Planning. There he is, Mr. Brown.
Yes. Mack Community Park has submitted to the Planning Department the site development permit to develop Phase 1 of the park. And the park is actually zoned Res 3. So it has a long list of zoning conditions on things such as buffers and berms that relate to the residential neighborhood that was originally planned there at the time of the rezoning. Now it's important to note the county in developing the park isn't required to comply with all those zoning conditions. But it was discussed at a prior work session that even if that's the case, it may be the more attractive option go through the A1, the process to rezone this back to A1, and that's the item before you today. Not acting on the rezoning itself, but would the county want to initiate a county-sponsored application to take the property back to A1? If that's the pleasure of the board, you could have it on the April, most likely have it on the April 3rd public hearing at the Board of Commissioners.
That's what we should do.
Yeah. Could not slow anything down with this, are we? Nobody.
It would, I believe not. I think Tim knows a little more about the development side of it than I do, and then throw it at him like that. I hate to, but
I don't think that it does slow anything down.
Okay.
I don't think it does. There was some concern with some of the existing zoning conditions, and I think though as those get removed, they simply don't fit a park the way they fit a subdivision. It's kind of apples and oranges, and also going through a public hearing process, if the nearby residents have any concerns about the park, it gives them a chance to come out and discuss what that is and bring that to the table for us to try to address. So
what's that area appear on the future land use contest.
Majority of that area is suburban residential.
So why don't we zone it to something appropriate for that?
Because we're going to use it for parks.
But that's what everybody else has to suffer under that map. Why shouldn't we? All we're trying to get out is the variances and stuff on it.
Well, we're not suffering. I mean, it's we can change it. We're going to put a park there one way or the other.
Well, but the future land use map says something like Res 3 or suburban living. People always use that. That's why you get more suburban living. Why not start it off that way?
When is the future? It had to do with your question. Sorry. Yeah.
Well, it has that zoning today. And we have multiple choice. We can leave it as Res 3.
Is it the zoning or is it the conditions or variances?
It's the conditions.
It's the conditions that caught my staff's eye. Because they said
high school is zoned Res 3.
They have, there's things on there like a buffer or a berm along a specific property line.
And they may still want it.
And it's yeah, something like it says all homes need to have a two-car garage. Clearly, that's not going to apply once you build a park instead of a neighborhood. But yeah, something like a berm, I could anticipate some people might come out and say, hey, we still deserve our berm even though this is a park and we were planning on it and what happened to it. So that's why I started discussing it with Tim. And we talked with Ken as well, and he reminded us, which we knew, but he reminded us that we're under no legal requirement to do these conditions.
Sure.
And so we could move forward as is. We could do a zoning condition amendment to just clear off the zoning conditions. But at a prior work session, the call was a desire to talk about rezoning it to A1.
This is going to be your area. When you get up there, if there was any berms or setbacks or buffers that are involved, and in where having a park, you might want to consider just keeping those in play.
But you can't.
If it doesn't get in the way.
Right. It could be a berm that would be cause all kinds of water backup on a field. You know, it's all dependent upon where it is and how it would be.
Wherever possible, you may want to.
I sort of like that idea of removing or moving. I mean, he just said Lambert High School sitting on a Res 3 right now. I think we're just asking for problems.
Can I ask this though? If we go back to, let's say, A1 to do the park as is, as it comes up, certainly Park and Rec Board listens to these complaints by people around there. We probably need to accommodate what we can, like we trusted it.
Well, that's why you said with a public hearing, you'd start to tell people what our plans are for us.
Right.
And I think it is important, though, to consider is, are you going to be setting the example of all county projects in the future?
Yeah, because there have been other properties that have been bought that were zoned for different things and then were bought by the county and not treated this way.
There's one other aspect to this. There actually, this park sits on property that has two different zones or were approved for two different developments. So those zoning conditions are slightly different between those two different zonings. So that's another part of this.
Well, I agree, going back to the A1 list to our park, but I think you need to listen to any of your concerns from the citizens out there too while you're doing it. We've done it at the other parks. We've turned lights. We've done additional screening for the lights.
I assume he did that when he bought the park, did he not? When the park was bought?
I don't know if we had any plans. We had no plans for it then, so now we got plans for it. So you want
to take. But you recommend then to go to public hearing and go to A1. That's what you're recommending?
No. Actually. This came up at a past work session. I wasn't at the meeting, but the direction I got from the minutes was that the Board of Commissioners wanted to discuss the possibility of an A1 rezoning. So my only goal when I brought it to talk about it with Tim was I wanted everyone to be aware of the conditions were out there and that as we move forward, there was going to be a chance you'd hear from these people. Hey, where's my berm? Where's my buffer?
Well, and you're right. They may not realize this. Some neighbors may not realize this is going to be a park.
I think they all do.
Yeah,
I mean,
now they get the plans.
Most of them were very happy not to have the subdivision.
Yeah, I guess they all know it's a park. If they know they're getting
some
berm or not,
reservations
the
about the park.
What do you
want
to do?
I mean, Kim, what do you think we should do?
Two things. I mean, on the one hand, I understand sort of the policy rationale, the notion of at least let the citizens come and have an opportunity to address and, you know, say it out loud why these conditions are not going to be applicable. The only other thing is when you set a process in motion, just be ready to live and die by that process. And so when
what they begin- concerns me is that we've spent all these hundreds of thousands of dollars on design, and if we were going to ask for public input, we should have done it before we went to design. I mean, now that we've got it designed, are we going to go and spend a ton of money to change design? It just feels like to me we've done this out of order.
I don't think they're going to look at you to change the design of the park. It's just some of the conditions that may have to do with buffers. Well, because you're not building a subdivision now, so those things won't apply to the structure
they
itself.
They could come back and want no lights, uh-huh. Certain kind of lights.
Another way.
I mean, it does open up a can of worms when you have the subdivision.
Well, it's your district. It's your district. You have to live
did
in
Did you finish? I interrupted.
No. I mean, that was it. Just. Sometimes one of the worst situations for a board is to be in front of a bunch of folks. You set up this process, and then when they begin to make requests of you, you look at the master plan and what you've already done, and just sort of get into the issue you've raised is, are we going to modify the plan now?
Is
so just
not doing
be mindful
the
of that.
Order. So is there a way of removing the conditions? I mean, what's our options? Our options are to go return it to
forward,
A1.
Move forward. Develop the park on Res 3 property with conditions is option one. Option two is rezone. The agenda item that's in front of you, rezone it to A1.
With a public hearing.
Public hearing through the normal zone process. Option three would be a zoning condition amendment to say we're going to leave it as Res 3, but we're going to have a public hearing to wipe off the zoning conditions. Those, I think, are the three most obvious choices.
You did that at Lambert. I mean, is there advantages?
The only thing I would ask is if we go into the notion of modifying the zoning of the conditions, we need to be very clear to the public, because what I don't want to do is to have citizens begin to go out and look at every other county or Board of Education on property and say they're encumbered by these conditions and they've not been adhered to.
And my
concern is that we're not required to, we're not, other sovereign entities aren't subject to zoning. Board of Education's counties, they're just not subject to zoning. And that's going to be, it's going
to
be.
We're not subject to the zoning conditions to begin with.
No, ma'am. No.
I mean, so why are we making this be a deal?
Because he was at, he says that he observed the minutes from the Board of Commissioners.
The reason was there are conditions that I think some neighbors may expect. Neighbors aren't going to know the detail of what Ken knows, that, well, we don't have to comply with those conditions because of 10 different court cases. There's going to be neighbors out there that may expect they're going to get their berm and buffer. And the only intent was talking about just that, making sure.
And that's a lot
talk about on the front end, rather everyone is too late on the back end.
They got a berm.
And that's a laudable goal. I just don't want to confuse people that if we set a process, I agree with that because they're not going to understand.
Why don't you just take the conditions off and leave it like it is? That satisfies Jim Suburban Living.
But you get Jim Suburban Living, and you take the conditions, but you still have a public hearing.
Yeah, you still got a public hearing. The only way not to have a public hearing is to start grading and take the wrath.
And with that, maybe say have a letter of what applies legally to the county and why to all the neighbors around.
There might be a fourth option, Commissioner Mills. It might be to have a public hearing but not call it a zoning action, and have it the public hearing for the purposes of bringing some fit folks in and explaining what we're doing and why.
But can they bring up the end that, well, I got a berm back there and I want to keep that berm?
That's when I get to be the bearer of bad news. I'm happy to do that.
With Lambert or there have been plenty of other parks that were zoned for subdivisions or zoned for schools that were, and did they meet the requirements that the subdivision had before? I don't think so. And why it's never, has this ever been brought up as an issue before?
I think the schools always come in and ask for a zoning out of courtesy.
They do. I see Tim Amers. I see him.
Did you say Lambert was Res 3?
It was zoned Res 3.
But they took the conditions off of it.
Yeah, the schools typically do it as a courtesy. Mm-hmm. We've had.
I already had the land disturbance permit.
Before they took the conditions off.
Years ago, I believe at Hampton Library, we had a variance. Board opted to put it through the public hearing process just to give everyone an opportunity to discuss it, even though it wasn't required. So there's been a mixed history.
I'll make the motion that we move forward with your suggestion of leaving it as a Res 3 or suburban living as on the map, but do a public hearing in accordance to removing all the conditions and variances.
Second.
For Matt Parr.
Motion is second. Explained by Commissioner Mills. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Got it, Tom?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Item 10, MOU with Perkins.
Mr. Chairman, this is a memorandum of understanding with the Georgia DOT. As you may know, State Route 369 is going to have some work, and we have water lines on the DOT right away that have to be moved. This particular one's in conflict with the bridge, and what this is our agreement that the DOT will include. We've got two options. We can work with the DOT and they can put this construction in their bid package, or we can hire it out separately. What we would propose to do here, we will still have to hire an engineer to design the water line to hang on the new bridge. We'll give those plans to the DOT. They'll put them in their project. They'll bid it out, and then we'll pay for it. This is the first step when we work with the DOT to enter into this agreement, these agreements. That's what this one.
We pay for the engineering work or pay for
we will pay for the engineering work and the whatever it costs
to relocate
after they bid it. There's another agreement. Barry Lucas here. Barry usually works with the DOT. We have another agreement as far as the construction.
Yeah, the second one's called the Contract Item Agreement, a CIA, and that'll come
later,
right before the project is bid.
But before they start making plans to include this in their bid documents, they require us to agree to get this in place. And like I said, we would have to hire an engineer, one of our engineers, to do the design work and then give that to the DOT.
Do we ever get reimbursement from the state?
All right, one question. When we bid these out, we bid out the individuals and we manage these, do we, is it cost typically the same as what the state does, less or more? Historically,
we think there's an advantage on the coordination and the timing. I would say it's always been comparable. We've never bid it both ways at the same time, but we felt like we got fair prices from the DOT contractors. And on these complex jobs where you've got to do your staging and timing, it gets difficult to have a third contractor in there on a DOT job, and it typically works most of the time. Couple of times, not, but most of the time works better for the DOT to be managing, and they will oversee the bidding and the contract directly.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the board? We have a motion on item 10, the MOU.
Make a motion that we approve the MOU, Georgia Department of Transportation for relocation of water lines. State Route 369 at Six Mile Creek that are in conflict with the construction of a replacement bridge and is outlined in our manuals and discussed by Tim Perkins.
Second.
Motion is second. Any other discussion? With approval, item 10. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Item 11.
Okay. This one is a little different, even though the language is the same. This is a standard DOT form. The difference, it says this is an area that's in conflict with construction of replacement bridge. Actually, this would be new construction. This is the line that goes across the lake into Hall County. We're requesting this. We believe now's the time to put the line on the bridge to connect up to Hall County. When the Governor's Water Reliability Act that he completed a couple years ago, and I don't have the right legal name for that study, it came back and said that the goal was for all water systems to have backup, and we were supposed to have interconnection with other systems so that we could supply, I believe, 20% or 25% of our water in case of a natural disaster emergency, that all the water systems throughout the Atlanta region is interconnected for drought protection and other issues. One of the requirements, I don't know how forceful it could be, but one of the requirements said that we should connect up to Hall County.
Gainesville,
actually. We may have said Hall County, but Gainesville is who the water's going to come from. And we've reached out to Kelly Randall with the City of Gainesville. We're hopeful when it comes construction time that we may be able to share the cost But this particular agreement is the same thing. We need to get a design done. If we're ever going to hook up to Gainesville Hall County, you have to make plans for it when they're designing the bridge. They have to allow for the extra weight of the pipe and the water hanging on the bridge, or you can't do it. So we think we need that backup to our system. And so this one's not a have to. We don't have to do this one. But you would probably have to bury it through, go under the lake somehow. It's the right time to do it. And it'll be an emergency backup supply for.
And would it go both ways?
It would go both ways, that's correct.
Wouldn't have a check valve.
We would put valves on both sides. We could supply water to them, they could supply water to us.
Would there be a tap on fee usually, if we just share it?
All those things, in our discussions with Gwinnett and others, there's no tap on fees for this. If you're asking for a permanent water supply, something you're going to get water on a regular basis, you get into those connection fees and system impact fees, but not for requirements like this.
On this one and the one we just voted on, is everything, would everything still be okay as is if the lake ever goes to 1073?
Yes.
We don't worry if we got like 1080 then.
Yeah, watch the bridge. Some problems we're going to have. Yeah.
Now, I know the county line's what, at the middle of the bridge?
Correct.
So, are we waiting? We got to have Hall County agree to it, or are we going to foot the whole bill?
We make that decision when it comes time to actually award the contract. But preliminary indications are that Gainesville also sees the need and benefit. We're hopeful they'll help fund it. Okay. We funded some of the others across State Route 20 and the Guinness Ferry Road on our own dollar to get across the bridges. They're not quite as long. It's 369 bridges. Pretty long.
We wouldn't have to pay for any updated bridge to hold the weight in. The state would take care of that.
Correct.
They just have to know the weight of the pipe and the weight of the water.
So the 16, if we wanted to go larger than that, we would have to pay it. We're asking for 16 inch.
Okay. Any other questions? Do I hear a motion from the board on item 11?
I'd like to make a motion that we approve the memorandum of understanding with the Georgia Department of Transportation for location of water line at State Route 369 to Chattahoochee River for new construction in Hall County.
Second. Have a motion second for approval of item 11. Any more discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-2. Item 12, Mr. Perkins.
Number 12 is the same road, 2 Mile Creek. It is mandatory. There's conflict in the new bridge. So that we do not have an option on this one, but to move the water line.
Tim, if it were to come that the non-optional ones are a lot more expensive than was anticipated, would that be a reason not to do the optional one, or is the governor's request, in your mind, overriding?
I think we have that option later, and I not something we would want to do, but if the bid comes back from the Department of Transportation and we don't feel that it's good pricing, I believe, Barry, we would still have the option to take it on our own, rebid it.
Least the bridge, we could do it hanging to the bridge this way.
Correct.
But if we say we want to have the option, the bridge can be built so we can hang to it.
Correct.
So that's why you do it. Okay. Is there a motion on item 12?
Number 12, make sure I'm in the right place. I'll make a motion that we approve the memorandum of understanding with the Georgia Department of Transportation for relocation of waterline in State Route 369 at 2 Mile Creek that are in conflict with the construction of a replacement bridge.
Second. Now, motion and second for item 12 for approval. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0. One more, Mr. Perkins.
Similar agreement. This particular one is for Bethelview Road between Castleberry and State Route 20. The same thing. We want to include the design work in the DOT's bid to widen this road. This particular project, the relocation expense for the line is funded through John's department as far as the splice or...
splice for replacing what's there.
Replacing existing line. But we'll be funding the design.
Yeah, but they've already moved some of it added to it.
From Castleberry down to 400 South on Bethelview's already been relocated. This is to go along with the
next phase.
Well, we move this before they start construction, so it's not going to work.
It'll be during construction.
During construction.
They come in and do the rough grading.
Yeah, we come back. We did rough grading on the other part, and they still got a 20-foot water line.
Yes, sir.
I hear a motion of item 13.
The motion we approve. Memorandum of understanding with Georgia Department of Transportation for relocation of water lines at CR 455 Bethelview Road from SR 20 to CR 8 Castleberry Road that are in conflict with the reconstruction of the road.
Second. Have a motion second for approval item 13. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Thank you, Mr. Perkins.
Thank you.
Item 14, John.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Item number 14 is approval to submit application to the state of Georgia for funding assistance from local maintenance improvement grant program in the amount not to exceed $1 million for the Castleberry Road widening project. The board was provided. Well, Mr. Chairman and the board was provided a letter from Keith Golden back on February 6th at a presentation at a board meeting, and within that letter it sets forth requirements that this application be submitted to GDOT in order to receive that $1 million. So this is just my request for the board to authorize that. And I'd like for it to be time sensitive as well.
But what are some of the conditions? Do they depict how big the road has to be, or just that we approve it? What does it say, John?
I don't know. Let's see an application that we put. The description of work in the application is 4 lanes with a 20-foot raised median.
So that's the only way they'll get $1 million if we do a 4-lane with raised median?
That's what we put in the application. That's the only project that we have designed, so that's the way we're submitting it.
When did you submit that?
We hadn't submitted it yet. This is approval of the board to submit the application.
Any other questions? All right, here
I make a motion to, on time sensitive motion that we, for approval to submit application to the state of Georgia for funding assistance from local maintenance and improvement grant, LMIG program, in the amount not to exceed $1 million for Castleberry Road widening project.
Second, on time sensitive basis.
Discussion.
Discussion?
$1 million. Do you have any reason why they found $1 million to do a road that doesn't justify for traffic count to do it, an expansion yet, other than widening one of their own intersections, and why we got stuck putting money into their roads, intersection after intersection, $800,000 to $900,000 a pop, when they said they didn't have money, but yet they could find $1 million to get us to spend $12 million?
I can't answer that.
So I think our traffic count showed it needs to be 4-lane, didn't it, John?
How's that?
Well, yeah, all of our studies show.
How's that? You got a little over 7,000 cars
a day. Not traffic count.
The county lowered its standards intentionally at one point to 14.5 from a national standards that are 19,000. It's still half of what our standards are and almost one third of what national standards are. How do you figure that?
That's not a true statement.
How do you figure?
Because I know what our standards have been.
Well, did you not tell me we had it lowered to 14.5 back there in 2004? I've got the documents sitting on my desk. I pulled the motion. Everybody and all the statements are made in that meeting.
No, I don't recall that.
And then the DOT has a book they go by for national standards, and it says around the 19,000 mark.
But don't you think at some point, I mean, if you want to argue these counts, this road is going to qualify for whatever count it is you keep moving around.
Point in time.
So by the time it gets built, I mean, do you want to wait till it's failing? It will relieve traffic in the area.
No, it won't.
That's,
you're
that's
wrong.
A fact. Number two,
widening Highway 9, if the state would do that,
nine,
would release
but
traffic.
But it's 7 or 9
area.
Years away. We that's, don't own the right of way.
But why is it 7 or 9 years away?
Because we don't own, they don't own the right of way.
And we don't have
they fact, the highway. So are they giving us $1 million to
do the
get us to widen Castleberry
to
detour traffic off of their responsibility under ours?
I don't. I mean, if we
it
got
will relieve traffic maybe. In the area. It's the fastest relief for traffic
it's
in the area.
It's not going to relieve
not
traffic,
only that,
but it's not traffic.
And there's been fatalities on the road.
It will.
They can straighten the road, do the same elevation changes on the two lanes.
You know, they can close
we've
got
to look for the future to move traffic through this county. You look at, go down to Rawls.
Okay, look.
Go down to Rawls. They got four lane roads everywhere. They go through subdivisions.
At some point in time, the tires in your vehicle are going to wear out. But you don't change the ones that are have a lot of tread on and are still good shape. Before you change the one on the cars that are showing tread, need to be changed.
No. Nope.
There's other roads in our county need to be
fixed
first.
Example, you should change all your tires at one time.
Yeah.
And a four-wheel drive truck. To
yes.
Ride the same.
I'm talking about different vehicles. So you should fix the roads that need it first. You should have prioritized and fix the roads that need it first, since we don't have enough money. You guys are looking to put a $230 million bond out there to fix roads because there's not enough money to do them. So all you got to do is act responsible for the public's money and fix the roads that need it first and take them in priority.
Okay, we've had a motion and a second on time since the base of item 14. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries, 3-2. Item 15, General, this is the time since the base of, I'm sorry to say it like that.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, actually 15, 16, 17, I'll ask those all be time sensitive, but number 15 is acceptance of proposed change order. Gresham Smith and Partners for additional scope of services on Castleberry Road widening project from Buckview Road to Hutchinson Road in an amount not to exceed $52,209.49. Just to briefly describe the additional scope of services for this design work is basically to ready the project for bidding. There'll be design revisions required at the Bethelview Road project, where we were moving a section of that project that was incorporated into it because the project came before Castleberry. And we've also got to update the erosion and sediment control plans. And we got to update our environmental permit and submit for a state buffer variance. So that's the reason for the additional scope.
So 15 is all about the design and engineer work for Castleberry?
Correct.
And the company is Gresham?
Gresham Smith.
And that's the same company that wrote the report that said we'd be up to about 14,000 cars a day, but we're only around 7,000. I got the report on my desk, but I have to go get it because you think I might tell you.
Well, I've got the reports too, and if we want to go over them, we can. But
that's
not
what
this
is.
Listen, I don't think it's appropriate for you to do that.
Do you
wanted to talk about the reports of the traffic count, you should have brought that information.
Do you want
instead
to
of
use
the
same
going
company
after him
that got it wrong by almost 100%?
You know what? I want to make a time-sensitive motion for the acceptance of proposed change
order
with Gresham Smith and Partners for additional scope of services on the Castleberry Road widening project, Bellevue Road to Hutchinson Road, in an amount not to exceed $52,209.49.
We have a motion and a second for time sensitive item 15 for acceptance.
Y'all get ready to vote on a company that got it wrong by almost 100%.
We will talk about that later. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries, 3-2. Item 16, time sensitive. John?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Item number 16 is acceptance of proposed change order with Gresham Smith and Partners for additional scope of services on the Old Atlanta Road widening project from Sharon Road to McGinnis Ferry Road in an amount not to exceed $84,428.55. This additional scope of work is due to the fact that we are now splitting one phase of the project into three separate projects due to the timing of the construction. We'll have a phase from St. Marlow to McGinnis Ferry Road, and then a later Splash 7 phase that'll be from Old Atlanta Club to St. Marlow. And there's currently an unfunded phase, which will be from James Burgess Road to Old Atlanta Club. We're also having to update the sediment erosion control plans due to change in policies, address CPD comments. We're adding water line, plan view location, and water line quantities to the plans for relocation of our county water line. And we've also had some unexpected coordination with GTC transmission tire revisions. And we've had to add a signal at the Atlanta Road in St. Marlow that wasn't anticipated originally. So that's the reason for this additional scope of work to ready these projects for bid for construction.
Did you send this work out to bid, or did Gresham Smith just automatically get it?
Gresham Smith is already under contract. This is supplemental agreement. Their contract, original design contract is $1,056,853. And they've had, they still have a total remaining balance there, but this is a supplemental agreement to an existing design contract.
Any other discussion? We hear a motion for item 16 on time-sensitive basis.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I'd make a time-sensitive motion for the acceptance of proposed change order with Gresham Smith and Partners for additional scope of services on the Old Atlanta Road widening project from Sharon Road to McGinnis Ferry Road in an amount not to exceed $84,428.55.
Time-sensitive. Second. Time-sensitive. Have a motion and a second for time-sensitive item 16. Any other discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries 4-1.
And get their numbers right. I'm concerned about this company.
Okay. That's interesting. I'd like to see how you vote on the next item.
Item 17, John.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Item number 17 is acceptance of proposed change order, Gresham Smith and Partners, for additional scope of services on the Union Hill Road, Mullinax Road widening project from McFarland Parkway to State Route 9, in an amount not to exceed $32,606.73. This additional scope of work is to update the Center for Erosion Control plans due to changes in policies, aggressive comments. We're adding waterline quantities to the plans. We've had to have significant revisions on parcel 36. Drainage revisions. We've also got design revisions due to the SR9 widening and design revisions west of Post Road. Additional right-of-way revisions have been required on this project due to all the things that we've agreed to during our right-of-way negotiations, where we had originally anticipated only about 50% of the parcels needing right-of-way revisions. We're probably closer to around 90%, so it's been pretty extensive increase in right-of-way plan revisions on the project. So we're recommending the board approve a supplemental agreement to the existing design contract in an amount of $32,607.
Mr. Tam, I'm in favor of the project. I'm just a little bit concerned with the engineer firm because I thought the numbers were off 10%, 15%, 20%. It wouldn't be concerning, but it could be as much as 100% off of the traffic count with that approach.
Well, we're talking about Casper.
No, he wants to see how I'm going to vote on Gretchen Smith.
We're talking about McFarland right now.
No, you're talking about
Mullinax.
John,
Mullinax. It's too McFarland.
On Mullinax, did you just, how much of the right of way has been bought so far?
I can't think exactly, probably a little over 50% now.
So we've already closed?
We closed on over half of them. We just closed on 8-9 at the intersection. And they're moving forward with that, the right turn lane.
That's pretty good, considering the time.
Good job.
Do we hear a motion for item 17?
I make a motion that we accept the proposed change order with Gresham Smith and Partners for the additional scope of services on the Union Hill Mullinax Road widening project from McFarland Parkway to State Route 9 in amount not to exceed $32,606.73, and it's time sensitive.
Second. That's why. Time sensitive. Have a motion and a second for time sensitive item 17 for approval.
Commissioner Levent, this is in your district.
I understand. I'm for the product. I'm concerned about the engineer firm. I also read an email one time that if you read it, it might make you wonder why they came up with those numbers in Castleberry.
Yeah, this is the same engineering firm.
That's right. I'm concerned about this engineer
firm. You're comfortable with them on this project?
I'm not saying they don't do the job right of drawing the plans. I'm worried about them in the traffic count. It's hard to support somebody that'll be told how to count numbers instead of doing real numbers.
So you don't think Mullinax needs 490?
I absolutely do. But that's not my problem. It's what they did on Castleberry. That concerned until they can explain to me why they changed those numbers up. It's drastically different than what they really are showing.
This is about Union Hill Mullinax. We have motion second for time sensitive item 17.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries, 4-1.
Mr. Brown, I apologize. I didn't mean to not to pass on you. It was just what you said, and my facts are incorrect, and I've got the paperwork. I had to defend that. Thank you.
We can talk about anytime you want.
Thank you, sir.
Item 18 has been removed. Item 19, Board Report, removal of Park and Rec Board, District 2. County Manager, are you ready to make the report?
Yes, sir.
You want to talk about that?
No, you go right ahead.
All right. Jerry's still here. So I think I'm going to ask to do this time sensitive, so start attending any meetings they might have, but I'll make a motion on the time sensitive matter. For board appointment, member of Parks and Recreation Board for District 2, the gentleman that I'd like to appoint is Joe Brown. His biography is attached.
Second, time sensitive. Any discussion? I have a motion second for time sensitive item 819 for approval. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries, 5-0. Item 20, Mr. Brown.
Yes, thank you. This item is a request from Commissioner Mills, and it evolved out of a series of discussions we had regarding the accuracy of stream information on rezoning site plans. And we looked at a few different options. We looked at options involving code change, code change to the Unified Development Code. But at the end of the day, we felt the best option was to talk about a policy change. It does not involve a change to our Unified Development Code. It does not actually even require board action. But I know it's a topic that you get a lot of input on from different groups, so I wanted to talk about it at the board.
I wanted to say what prompted me to start talking to Tom about it is I have a zoning that's coming up in District 4, and I happened at the first meeting with zoning attorneys, they laid out a plat on the table, and I happened to see that there was one possibility of two creeks on that plan. And then later, when they brought me back the site plan, there was no creek shown on it. And so that caused me a disturbance, because this will be the first zoning that I will have done in District 4. I feel like it sets a precedence to what other people will ask for later. And they were asking for a density of 2.5, and there was no way I felt like they could get it with the creeks on there, but they weren't showing the creeks. So I got to thinking about how can we really make good decisions if we don't have the creeks on there? Because if we zone to what's requested, we're setting up a false density. And then the next group will come through and they'll ask for the same thing. Now, whether maybe they could achieve it or not. But then I got to thinking even farther about what's going to happen after that. Well, after that, they're going to come back to us and they're going to say, you know, you gave me a 2.5 density, which we'll just make up, that was 100 homes. And I didn't know there was a creek on that property. And now I need to ask you, I have a hardship and I need to ask you for a variance to my hardship, which is the creek. And I'm not asking you for any more homes. I'm still sticking with the 100. The 100 that really couldn't have ever been achieved to begin with. So I have, it's just caused me a lot of grief because I see that as being like a double-edged sword that just keeps going after us. And a third comment is that when you keep coming back with, when you present plans and it's not shown accurately, whether us commissioners are to blame for that or not, we get the blame for it. And then there, people seem to think that there is some type of undercover, you know, no good stuff going on. In what Tom, and I'll let Tom go back and present, I just wanted to give a little background information of where this came from. I didn't just dream it up. It was really an epiphany of sorts because I haven't had a zoning. And when I had this one, I'm thinking, whoa, whoa, whoa. No wonder we're setting ourselves up for trouble. And I mean, we've created loopholes that come back to bite us again and again that can be avoided.
It's very similar to what I wanted to do with putting the actual zoning approval for the density rather than just res 3 on the maps. So if it was res 3 with a density of 2.1, that was captured. But go ahead.
Okay.
The Unified Development Code today requires, it identifies preliminary location of streams need to be shown on the site plan. And we've all been through public hearings where we know that's a contentious issue. You'll have the applicant with one opinion, you'll have surrounding property owners or environmental groups with a significantly different opinion. And what I've seen, it puts the board in a difficult position the way you just described. The proposed policy that I think will help with that would be when the zoning is initially submitted at a staff level, we already coordinate with the engineering department on reviewing traffic implications, access, turn lanes, all those things. We'd also coordinate with them to conduct a preliminary field inspection of the site. They'd actually send someone out there to walk the site, compare it to the product that was submitted, and if they saw significant oversights, they report back to our long-range planning staff, and we require the site plan to be updated before it moved on to the public hearing stage. That would take some coordination between John and my office. We'll have to work out the deadlines and how we pass the documents back and forth, but all in all, it's not that complicated of a solution other than having to meet the deadlines and pass the documents back and forth. So wrapping it up, it's not involving a UDC change. It's a policy change that the planning department has all the power currently to implement.
You'll just add to the application a checkbox?
We'll clarify in the application, make the people aware of the process. And really coming up here today was just to hear some input and hear if it sounded like we were on the right track. And if so, we would begin work on implementing that.
I mean, it's not a... I personally didn't think it would be fair to do a full wetland delineation before you do your zoning, because that's very costly, and it could be they don't get the zoning, and I didn't think it was fair to ask all of that to be done, especially that involves agencies that are not under our control, our own staff. But with this, they will have to, what was it called, a boundary? What was it John called it? A stream?
Well, we were just saying identifying buffered state waters.
Buffered state waters.
And this just entails one of the engineering department making a trip out there and kind of walk the land, doesn't it?
If they request.
John, you want to talk about that at all?
Well, yeah, if the application and or the site plan at the time of submittal would indicate the potential state waters on the property, then we would have one of our staff members to visit the site and affirm whether or not it appears to be accurate and all-inclusive. And if not, then our staff would note that, and then the applicant would have to have their surveyor to go out and locate the buffered state waters that we've identified and show them on the concept plan. So we're only talking about buffered state waters only and not wetlands. Not unbuffered state waters, but just buffered state waters.
I think it's a step in the right direction.
It's a step in the right direction. Unfortunately, you'll still have folks that think you're supposed to have an exact science at that point, and it's just not. Not until there's a zoning passes.
This is better than the current process. It's an improvement. It's not going to be a fully engineered design with an environmental report from a consultant that's delineated all the jurisdictional waters and state waters. But it's going to be a whole lot better than the current process, and it's going to be fairly accurate at showing you what you need to make decisions during the zoning process.
And then we can know when we zone something that they are responsible for showing us those creeks, and when they come back asking for a variance, we can say, whoa, whoa, whoa.
You knew that or
you
should
knew
have
that. Well, you had to submit that at the time. And so it gives us another level of knowing.
Seeing it's not really a hardship.
Right.
Self-inflicted hardship.
And it's really allowing Tom to be able, them to do their job.
Ken, what about the idea I'll say requiring that the county be allowed onto somebody's land in order to look at this? Is that an issue?
It's really not. I mean, once you submit to sort of the jurisdiction by way of either seeking a zoning or even for instance permitting, whenever we have permitting, you are basically authorizing, you know, limited incursion onto your land so we can regulate. And so that's for the very same reason that one of our electrical inspectors can go onto your property to view a site. The same thing would be applicable.
So Tom was really looking for everybody being good.
Is everybody all right with change of policy? Without exception, yeah.
Okay. That's all I needed. It really was update testing the waters.
And you can start doing that.
We're going to
test the waters. Good point.
we'll start coordinating on all the details of just working between two departments immediately.
You got that.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Item 21 has been postponed to April 8th. Item 22 has been postponed to April 22nd. Item 23. E-cigarettes, state law regarding. Do you have this, Counselor?
Well, I can. I will kick it off, and then the board can discuss it. There has been some discussion, and candidly, it's kind of serendipitous, actually, because it's beginning to take off everywhere, the notion of regulation of e-cigarettes. And I'm not terribly familiar with them, but I do know this. I do know they do not emit burning smoke. They, as I understand it, they emit some sort of almost a steam product, like vapor. But they do involve a heating element. I believe there is some nicotine delivery. That's what I understand. They're supposed to emulate the effect or the sensation of smoking, but not actually have the secondhand smoke or the inhaled smoke, component of smoking. The question that was presented to me, based upon, I think, some questions that have been presented from the community to commissioners was, number one, do we have anything that regulates e-cigarettes? The answer I can tell you quite candidly is no, we don't. In fact, candidly, Forsyth County as a government has very little regulation on cigarettes of any kind. You may recall we took up the issue of smoking in county parks some time ago, and we did employ some regulations with respect to that, but otherwise we don't. Georgia has a state law called the Smoke-Free Air Act that prevents smoking in most enclosed locations. However, the definition of smoking in that act talks about lighted tobacco products. So I do not think that even the Smoke-Free Air Act would pertain to e-cigarettes. So candidly, there's really kind of a regulatory void there. As far as I can see, to some of the commissioners that had asked about this, I had done a quick survey. It looks like Chatham County has expanded their definition of smoking or cigarettes to include e-cigarettes, as has DeKalb County. And so I don't know what the outcome of this discussion is and whether we want to begin getting into the business of regulating e-cigarettes at all. But the question that was presented to me, and I think the question for discussion today was, is what is the status of our regulation on this? I can answer that very quickly. There is none. What is the status of it with respect to the state law? And I can tell you I've not been able to find any. And I don't think it's being addressed in this session of the General Assembly. I'm not aware of it.
I don't know what the bill is. There is a bill in that has a reference to e-cigarettes.
There is a bill that does have a reference. I have not seen it.
I don't know that he even made it over to crossover. Okay. I don't know.
And I've not seen it. So
don't we have an age limit on, didn't mean to interrupt you, age limit on e-cigarettes? Is that to sell?
I mean, to the extent that it's a nicotine delivery system, you would assume so, but I candidly don't. I don't know.
I think it's totally unregulated.
And if you look, and if you Google e-cigarettes right now, you will see that all across the nation, it is the regulatory rage. I mean, you can see there's bills in Congress that are pending, and you can see the lobbyists are attempting to stop those, and there's various states where it's so.
New York has already taken a stance. Los Angeles, Chicago.
Again,
it is the hot topic, and it's now a billion-dollar industry.
Well, yeah, but it's. Is the issue that it's a nicotine delivery system, or is the issue that it's an e-cigarette that could deliver other things which are combustible?
Both.
Well,
I think they're both.
Yeah, there's more secondhand pressures.
It's the vapors. They don't know what the vapors do to people.
There are vapors?
Yeah, it is vapors. They call it vaping. In fact, they have vaping bars.
Oh, but not secondhand vapors.
Well, vapors
they
come out
from it. Well, I mean, at some point,
yeah. What can we do legally, Ken?
Oh, well, I mean, you could. I mean, the field, there's no preemption concerns, at least that I can see at this point. You know, the state of Georgia has not spoken and preempted the field on this area. We could regulate in this area, but whether to regulate in the area.
The first complaint we got was email was somebody was smoking an e-cigarette in the library. And I don't think the library staff knew it. but that was the first. Did we have a, and then this last lady that was concerned about it had seen it at other public places where regular smoking was prohibited.
Is there a possibility that we can get an expert on this field, medical field, to tell us what it does and does not do secondhand?
Well, we could do that two ways. One would be we could try and research the literature and see if there's any literature at all on this field. That would be the cheapest way. If you actually want to retain or invite someone to come and speak to you at a work session, I could research that as well, whether they would do it gratis or whether they would want a fee. I would report that to the county manager.
The Center for Disease Control, Jody sent out an article to all of us yesterday, and the Center for Disease Control has yet to make a, they said it's not been out long enough to study, and therefore they're hesitant. They don't know the lasting, the impact or the effects.
I mean, I personally, you know, if there was a way to say that you can't have nicotine, I think I'd be for that. But the fact that you might have an e-cigarette that has, I don't know, something that's known to be harmless, water in it, I don't know if they would work that way.
They make marijuana they're using in them now.
Well, that we've already outlawed that. Okay, I don't know how you can simply say a plastic cigarette that has some kind of a combustion chamber in it is illegal.
I really do think they have an age limit on what they can sell it to.
I candidly don't know.
We need more research.
You can't make it illegal if you can limit it to where
you can just say it, you can use it wherever
non-smoking qualifies as a smoker.
But what's your basis of that?
Well, I don't know yet.
So that's exactly it. You're about to make something illegal that we don't know anything about.
But he's not saying illegal. He's just saying they smoke those.
Or you're about to regulate
cigarettes.
Sound like we need more information. Somebody needs to do full research for us.
We don't allow chewing tobacco.
You can smoke a cigar at a cigar place.
Yeah, but I'm talking about a county park or something like that. We don't allow tobacco, but not all of it's smoking.
I think we need more.
Tobacco is at least warned against by the Surgeon General in some way, in some form. There's no warning from any kind of a known thing about nicotine.
Saying if you want to, instead of outlawing it, if you want to just lump it in with the others, that's an option.
It is, but shouldn't we get a little more information before we make that decision?
And to the extent that's the direction of the board, what information would be helpful?
I'd like to know for what the age limit can buy at the store. If they have the state of Georgia has a late age limit on it.
Or use of it. Yeah, right.
And what all kinds of vapors are they putting in it now? I understand it's different packets, and they can buy all different, you know. I don't think it's been around long enough to. What one of those articles Jody sent said that county, the reason they had made a motion for it to be used only in was the same thing, premise as secondhand smoke as secondhand vapors, and not knowing what the vapors might do to other people.
Can we read the verbiage or get some kind of minutes of discussion or who they may have had speak at these other places in other states that they came up with what information
that
made them decide this?
Sure.
Yeah.
That, I mean, they chose for some reason. I'd like to know what all they heard.
Didn't they say somebody said it's all kids at school doing it?
Oh, yeah.
That's good. The
kids, they didn't, but now they're getting one. My Bible study class said kids are walking up and down the hall with them and that they're hiding them above the whiteboards. And they even, teachers turn their back and they're smoking them in class and the school system knows.
She had to smell them or something.
They had no smell.
There's no secondhand smoke.
There's no odor.
So help the kids learn any better?
This is what I've seen.
This is helpful. I mean, I think I have some instructions to assemble some additional information and bring it back to me.
Okay, any other questions? Thank you, Ken. Thank you. Item 24.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, we received, and we get these from time to time, but we received basically packets asking the county to, first of all, be on notice of a proposed class action lawsuit regarding the sale of municipal derivatives. The first one was a class action against Trinity Funding Company, LLC, Trinity Plus Funding Company, and GE Funding Capital Market Services. That was one class action. Apparently there was some
civil liability related to those derivatives that has resulted in civil classes being sanctioned by the court and a lawsuit ongoing. We also received, it was at the same time, so I must assume they're somewhat related, a class action notice with respect to municipal derivatives by the Bank of America, N.A. As is often the case whenever I get these class actions, the first thing I have to figure out is whether or not we have any exposure or any liability for which we would want to receive any potential payment that might drive our decision making. I've gotten with Mr. Gruen and asked whether or not we had purchased any derivatives for the applicable period. He's indicated that he can find at least no record of us purchasing any. And therefore, in the absence of having purchased any derivatives, then we don't have really any skin in the game with respect to participating in these lawsuits. So I simply want to alert you to that. Mr. Gruen's here. He can answer any questions, but I certainly see no reason to do anything. I would simply like a motion from the board that with respect to agenda item 24, that the county attorney be authorized to take no action.
So moved.
Second. That's a quick discussion, Counselor. Any other discussion? Motion is second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That's easy. Good taking no action, Counselor.
Item
25, advanced ambulance service. Ms. Mills, Mr. Ball.
Yes, I'll go ahead. A while back, there were sort of exceptional process made for providing additional funding for advanced ambulance service. The unusual nature of it was, in my opinion, that it was out of the budget cycle. It was a request, I think, from the owner. Chief, I'm going to speak for you. Correct me, of course. I don't think the fire chief was in support of at least some of the conversation that went on at the time. And so I think Cindy and I had talked, and we were interested in bringing up the possibility of revisiting this and seeing if it should be brought to bid so that it might save the county some money.
I have a few other things that I felt like, in light of recent events, that I needed. I felt like the public needed to hear us have a conversation. I felt like that I've had people reach out to me, mothers in particular, on Facebook asking me what's going on, what happened, and I have, you know, said very little that I didn't know, but I would like to have some type of certitude to be able to go back and you know, just to reassure that the public is, that all is well and that there's safety there. Also, in speaking on that, that there is no risk of liability to the county in relation to what happened in the past and in going forward, if the county has any liability in that as well.
And you had to do it in a public forum? Instead of just calling the attorney?
You don't think the public should hear us
talk
about it?
But you could have called Kendra or you could have gotten an answer.
Let me offer up this, first of all, just from this perspective, and I know that everybody is trying to be as reasonable and discriminating as they can be in this discussion. And I first of all, applaud that and want us to continue with that. So let me just say this. With respect to any issues with respect to service or service interruption or service impact, I'm going to yield to the fire chief. So in other words, to the extent we want to address service, we can address that. To the extent we're talking about potential liabilities, I will say this and address the board this way. I am not aware of any potential liabilities with respect to any of the circumstances that have occurred either recently or candidly even further back than recently. My understanding is that with respect to interaction with patients or individuals being transported, there has been no issue raised with respect to those events. And so I want to leave that right there and kind of move on to the next issue. To the extent we're talking about service issues generally, is the service desirable? Is it prompt? Is it efficient? Is it the best bang for the dollar for the county? I would yield to the fire chief on that and see and let him address the board. But with respect to any recent events, I'd say that I appreciate it being raised. Obviously, it's, you know, the county's thinking about it, not aware of any liabilities based upon it.
and I think that perhaps we should focus the debate, if agreeable, on perhaps just the nuts and bolts of service being provided.
Okay. Chief, do you have any add to that about the service of the ambulance service, or are you satisfied? Is the county satisfied?
Mr. Chairman, the contract calls for advanced ambulance to arrive on the scene of a presumptive emergency. Give me an example. Shortness of breath, chest pains, head injury, the like. To arrive on the scene of a presumptive emergency within 8 minutes, 90% of the time, provable to the ambulance contract administrator, Captain Hamilton, monthly. They have met that standard every month. Captain Hamilton, did I just make a correct statement?
Yes, sir. Do you feel like our charges are equal to other counties or sitting around us?
Mr. Chairman, I've not done a comparative analysis, but at the will of the board, I can bring you that.
Well, Ken, maybe you could tell a little bit about the contract.
The contract that is in place right now has the standard language that is required by law with respect to multi-year county government contracts. Right now, the contract anticipates, I believe it would be fair to say the contract anticipates at least through a 2017 date. At least that's the way there is a subsidy we built into the last version of the contract, and at least anticipates that subsidy through 2017. But what the contract does provide is, to the extent that the Board of Commissioners wishes to terminate the contract, the standard language is in there, and that is that we would have to provide 30 days advanced written notice of non-renewal prior to the end of the upcoming calendar year. So, you know, my take on this agreement is, absent a breach, which is not what I'm hearing here, that it would need to provide notice at least 30 days prior to the end of the year, and then the contract would end at December 31st of the then existing calendar year, and that's going to be the same for every subsequent calendar year.
So, and when would you go out to bid? I mean, when would you?
Well, I mean, I would want to defer to Don on that, but to the extent that we're talking about taking action to change our ambulance service provider, I don't expect that is something that is done quickly. I expect that's something that would need some advance time, because you're going to have a seamless handoff.
And this person, an advanced ambulance, could put a bid in, and if they come back the best, I mean, they could be awarded it back. There's nothing stopping if they're competitive.
Yes.
There would be nothing to prohibit them being able to get the contract back.
No, ma'am.
I concur with Commissioner Bob in the fact that I wasn't on the board then. I did attend the meeting that Chief Bowman spoke against the raise, and that Donna spoke against the raise, and then I was also at a meeting when it was coming up for bid, and instead of letting it come up to bid, it was pushed 5 years more out. Instead of letting it come to bid, I have not seen that done again for any company since I've been on the board. I didn't see it happen in that year that I was watching meetings before I came on the board. I don't know that it best, and that's not saying anything against advanced ambulance. I just don't know that serves the citizens of Forsyth County fairly to not go out to bid, to not make sure. I don't know what the fear is. I don't know what the fear of a board would be to let it go back out to bid, and if it's the right thing, if it works, then you'll get it back. I don't know what the fear of commissioners would be to allow that to happen.
Let me ask Pat one question. How hard is it?
Don.
I'm sorry. How hard is it to put something like this out for bids?
This bid usually is out at a minimum for 4 months. It takes about a 4 month term at a minimum.
Yeah, so it's not something you do ever.
No, that's why it's usually a multi-year one, because it's an investment of equipment from the service provider that we make them put in. So that's why it's usually a minimum five-year contract. But it takes time for the people to respond and for us to get this out.
So it's not unusual to have a five-year contract.
No,
most counties.
And this one initially was a five-year contract.
But it was extended 5 years at the end of already.
years.
May I share some history? Chief, I have permission to address Chief Chief Shivers.
Chief Shivers, come forward.
Yes, sir.
Previous discussion, sir, that I had concerning the ambulance service when I first came on the Board of Commissioners, I had a conversation with you in reference to how we came about using advanced services. And there was an ambulance service prior to us, and Counselor, I guess I shouldn't mention that name of that company?
Or is it? You can mention the name of that company.
I believe it was Rural Metro, am I correct?
That's correct, yes, sir.
And at the time, Rural Metro was doing our contract. What was the level of service, and was there any issues with them always finding their ambulances in Fulton County instead of servicing our citizens?
It was less than desirable.
And that was a problematic, because ambulances are used for life-saving.
Of course.
And what year was that?
It was prior to 2008, so 2007, back 5 years.
Correct. And then when the bids came out in 2008, advanced ambulance came in $850,000. Priority came in at $1.189 million. Rural Metro came in at $842,000. But they weren't here doing the services that we were paying for.
That's correct, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
And for that reason of life-saving, it bothers me tremendously to put out the bid, and we know we have an ambulance company now that fell within the lowest bids, that remains within that price range and only going up with inflation, and has produced a service that meets their contracts every single month.
They get a 3% inflation every year.
Right, that's
and then
right.
You try to give them a 7% on top of that, that would have extended, it would have made over the life of their contract $350,000 more.
Ma'am,
that's
ma'am,
not like, that's not inflation.
Ma'am,
that goes way beyond inflation.
But we didn't. No,
no, we did, but it wasn't because he didn't want to.
But we needed this 3%.
Ma'am, they were utilizing a 7th ambulance and weren't paying for it. They were asking for some reimbursements for it.
And I've got no problem with that.
They have been doing it for years, asking for some kind of compensation for back services they provide us, although we didn't have to, but they've been so good to the county and the people here. I, for one, felt it was somewhat reasonable. I wasn't overpaying them. They were not getting back what they felt they produced in service for that time frame. They asked them for a fraction of the money. And after doing a study, we found out we needed the 7th ambulance. And then back in 2008, there was a preliminary request asking for a 7th ambulance. And those calls increased by 30% over the next 3 years, and that's why they were having to give us, because they had a contract to meet deadlines of time frame of 8 minutes. They felt it necessary to put that in there at their expense for that time to meet that contract, and they weren't being compensated for it. Until this board was able to afford a 7th ambulance, they were eating it for years.
Yeah, but now, don't we have to compensate them some?
Now we do for 7th ambulance, now that we have it.
If we terminate the contract early, we have to compensate them even more.
Even more.
Do you not feel that if they are that competent, do you not have confidence that they, if they are that competent and doing that good of a job, they will get the contract back?
Well, probably. I know.
I mean, I'm told by people way up at Northside Hospital that there's other companies out there that would love a chance to bid.
I believe that. I do believe that.
And that have excellent professional service. But we don't know. And do you not think that Ms. Cucarola is confident that she can look at the bids?
Sure she can.
And be able to see? So why are we doubting that she can't do her job?
Let me share that when Vance Amos came with their bid last time, they were about 35% lower than the Rural Metro that was in here.
So, but
what happens, Ms. Mills, if they all come back in at their higher rate of the bids, and this time, Advanced Ambulance comes back in and says, you know what, I'm going to cut them up in my bid because I was 33% lower than them last time. I'm going to come back up 20%. And what happens if we get stuck paying an extra $250,000 a year more than we do now?
We haven't had any complaints, and I agree with you.
We haven't had any complaints. And this is about life-saving. This is not about whether it's $10 more or not. This is life-saving stuff. And they perform to the level that meets what our fire chief that manages them asks for, and within their contract. If they were doing things bad, I get it. Just like Rural Metro, they went up for bid because Rural Metro was not performing to that level.
Yes, we're looking for complaints. Any other discussion at this moment? Do you want to make a motion anyway on this? If I want to make a motion or just up for discussion at this moment?
I mean, how soon do we need a motion made to be able to put it out to bid?
What was the last contract What was the annual renewal of the last contract?
2000. The last renewal would have clicked over, ended December 31st of 2013. We are in the middle of a new year, calendar year term right now.
Every year's renewal.
So we got three more years.
You can do it.
Three more years in this five-year contract.
But there's also a buyout. I mean, we have to do some kind of a buyout, did we not on this one?
That was discussed, but that never made it into the.
It did not. What's the chief told them, bring back the information on some other, what they charged?
Right, we could decide by the.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna do that.
What he charged?
Well, he said he could do some information, did you, chief?
Other jurisdictions are paying for private services.
Can I clarify what the board's directing me to do, Mr. Chairman?
Well, yeah, we haven't said, asked you yet, but what would you like to do?
Can I comment on one thing? I know Donna mentioned 4 months. I've got to believe that the process will take at least that long. Once you get this on the streets, you get the bids in and process, and that company, whoever it is, regardless of who it is, would need some time to ramp up. And I don't think it would be wise to consider this, if you move forward with putting this out for bid, too much later in the year. Yeah. If you're serious about this,
it
you probably need
now.
To move on it pretty quickly.
May would be the latest.
And Mr. Chairman, if you're wanting to get a comparative analysis, what adds to the difficulty is many of our contiguous counties around, the fire department provides the transport.
Oh, okay.
Cherokee does.
Cherokee and Hall.
That would be hard.
Yeah, and I know we discussed that one time. There's a lot more money than us hiring up on.
Don, is there a kind of a hybrid of that where we could go out and get some information from other companies to bring something back to the board without going out full-blown bid?
We could do like a request for information and just ask for, it depends on what information you're trying to find out. I could do a request for information from other jurisdictions. We wouldn't have to be even all within Georgia. Or if you're going to ask for, and it would be a request for proposal for this type of service, because we definitely would want to look at other things besides the price. That would be very hard to do. Because it would cost, it would lay people's hands open.
Yes.
And it would cost them money to provide that service.
But right now, we're satisfied with our service, correct, Chief Bowman?
That's a correct statement, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chief Bowman.
Do you have a motion?
So do you.
Or do you want to think about it?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Jim, you want to make the motion and if it does, it fails.
I'll think I'll wait at this point.
All right. I guess we'll gather more information and see. I'll talk to some people in hospital and see some of their inputs and services.
You're asking nothing from staff at this point.
Staff or chief at this point.
Thank you.
Thank you, chief.
Thank you, chief. Good day, sir.
Item 26, replacement counselor, conflict of interest. Counselor? This is happening more and more.
You can just replace it all together.
Did you hear about that?
Is that a
gym
out there?
Careful.
I'm not going to
get out
of here. Hey, I'll
tell you. Time says you're out.
This will be, I hope, really very, very quick. We have received a lawsuit by Mr. Ricky Johnson. He is currently incarcerated, serving, I think it may be as much as a 40-year sentence. He had previously brought a civil claim for money damages against the county, and that's being handled by Williams, Morris, and Waymire. They're the lawyers from ACCG handling the claim. I had requested to not be assigned the defense of the case based upon some extensive interaction I'd have with Mr. Johnson based upon his Open Records Act request to the county, and candidly, given what I knew his allegations were. He has now brought another lawsuit sounding in mandamus, which is basically when someone seeks to try and compel various county actors to take action. He has brought the lawsuit right now against Connie Brooker, who is the head of our indigent defense program on an administrative level. He is also trying to bring in Daisy Weeks, who is the chairperson of our indigent defense committee. Recently, he just filed a motion to name Judge David Dickinson as a defendant. Because money damages are not involved here, ACCG has declined coverage, which means I ordinarily would defend all of these actors. I wouldn't defend Judge Dickinson because the Attorney General would defend the Superior Court judge,
but I would defend anybody that wears a county hat. However, the county attorney under our indigent defense system has an appointment on the tripartite committee, and that is one of the entities that he is suggesting is not acted appropriately with respect to his defense. Basically, he is upset with his lawyer, and so he is bringing this case in mandamus, seeking to have the indigent defense committee appoint a lawyer. I feel like it's close enough where it presents a conflict for me. I would request that you authorize me to bring in Williams, Morris, and Waymire, the very lawyers that handled the other claim involving Mr. Johnson, and we will pay them my rate. I know those lawyers. I know them well. I think they will very quickly dispatch this case, but I do need your authorization to do that.
I didn't catch the conflict, though.
He is basically asserting that the indigent defense committee, which is how we administer our indigent defense, is not picking the right lawyers and not telling them the right things to do. I have an appointment. The indigent defense program in Forsyth County, the county attorney actually makes an appointment to that committee.
Okay.
So it's, I'm just trying to be as...
He's saying he has a bad lawyer.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
And then he did not...
You chose.
That my appointment chose.
Yeah.
That's right. So.
You gave it to them.
Sort of. Sure. Yeah. So it's just a matter of time before, you know, I'm named. So again, I prefer to go ahead and have another lawyer. They'll get rid of this case very quickly.
Yeah.
I have a motion to second to have a replace the lawyer because of conflict. All in favor, see if I'm saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Mullen action, Council. Was that time
sensitive,
Council?
No, that's fine. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We'll put this on a consent agenda. I'm going to go ahead and bring them into the loop.
Okay.
But I'll get it on.
Now, this next item you said was time sensitive.
This is time sensitive. This is a resolution involving some land acquisition. I've got a copy of the resolution. It was just handed to me before the meeting, so I don't have copies for you. But let me tell you what it is. It is for the acquisitions of parcels 8 and 9 in our Mullinax Road and Union Hill Road project. Because this land acquisition and potential condemnation was discussed in executive session under the Open Meetings Act, I have to bring it out here and you all approve it in open session before it's binding. And so let me go over the material parts of it. The material parts are the settlement would be with parcel 8, Robert Johnson and Sue Johnson. As to parcel 9, it would be Conrad Johnson as executor of Mary Johnson and Sandra Woolley as administrator of Gart Johnson's estate and Robert William Johnson. So we've got two parcels we're trying to close on. The parcels are otherwise. Parcel 8 is tax parcel 041061 and parcel 9 is 041062. Parcel 8 is the acquisition by the county of 0.094 acres of right-of-way and 3,472.52 square feet of temporary easement. The acquisition price for that is $28,511. Parcel 9 is 1.086 acres in fee for $200,000. Those amounts were either specifically discussed in executive session or they are within the latitude of negotiation that you give to the engineering department.
Did you need to give us a handout to follow along?
No,
I didn't have one. And so I've got a resolution here, but do you want it?
You only had one copy. It's the thing we approved already.
I understand.
You see it? No kidding. I've got notes. You can see it. Hand that down to Tom. No kidding.
I'll get right back to you.
No, please. That's no worries. So, again, it's parcel 8 and 9 of the Mullinax Road and Union Hill project. The property owners, which is what I'm required to tell you, I've already identified who the property owners are. I've identified the acreages that we're buying, and I've identified the amounts that we're spending. For us to have a binding contract or a binding settlement, you have to approve this in open session. I'm asking you to approve the resolution that I have just gone over the material terms with you on a time-sensitive basis right now.
Make a motion to approve the resolution disposing the abandoned properties to be acquired by the county pursuant to the settlement in the terms of the acquisition and approving that the related agreement to purchase real estate as presented by county attorney time-sensitive.
Thank you.
Second. Second one.
time sensitive.
Motion is second for time sensitive.
I have a question. So you want to move ahead with this?
It's the engineering firm that I am not comfortable with.
But you understand that without the engineering firm, the project doesn't move forward.
It's not the design what they do. It's the count of the traffic. I still would like to speak with their principals.
You like to count the traffic?
I would like to see their principals and talk to them, find out a little bit.
I'd like to call a question.
Call a question.
Thank you, Mr. Ball. He was being immature running.
Okay. Council, we call a question. We have to vote on call a question.
The motion to call the question requires a second and a simple majority to approve.
Anybody second? I'll second that.
We're going to vote.
Okay, well, let's do it.
Well, you second it.
Well.
Okay, well, motion is second to call a question. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Passes 5-0. We have a motion second to approve the resolution. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 5-0.
Mr. Hannah.
Counselor. Counselor, does need for another executive session?
Mr. Chairman, there is. Thank you very much.
So I hear a motion to recess the regular work session, enter to executive session for discussion, litigation, and acquisition, and our personnel. Have a motion second for recess. Counselor, what will happen after we get out of executive session?
Mr. Chairman, we will not be coming out for any additional action except to close the meeting.
Have a motion second to enter into executive session. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Five.
Good. Yeah. Yeah.
5:30. We're going to executive session. 13-minute break.
I can't wait to go to that billboard to go on mowing it.
Come on, it is true, isn't it? I wouldn't take that offensive. It is true. But everything's separated out.
Because I use that as my
a little tense there today, here, gentlemen.
It did.
A little tense.